Nah. They want.
I think everybody wants to get out on it. I think everybody bullshit.
And if you don't like this shit, you're a hater.
We're going to touch that shit too. We damn sure going to touch that shit.
They don't understand structure and organization and planning and, you know, being strategic. And, you know, they just think, hey, man, I recorded this shit. No one's going to throw it out.
Yeah.
I'm going to put it on YouTube.
I'm going to put it on SoundCloud and YouTube. That's them dropping a song.
You know what I'm saying? Oh, no. And then they hold on for dear life for the Revert Nation charts. That shit to me is hilarious. A chart that goes nowhere. You understand what I'm saying? That's a chart that goes nowhere.
Yeah.
Listen, I sit there and I chop it up with my man from Universal on a regular basis, my man Rap. And, man, they're like, man, that shit is for them. That's a playground for them. We don't look at that bullshit. Sell something. Then we take notice. That's real shit.
It's simple.
100%. 100%. You know what I mean? Some motherfucker came, he came in the Grove Bar talking about, yeah, I'm signed to Universal Republic. I said, yeah. I said, what's your rap name? So he told me what his rap name. I can't remember what it is right now, but if I say it, you probably know what I'm talking about. A little motherfucker look like a little version of Lil Wayne.
I know you were talking about Lil Twan.
Yeah! That's his name.
Lil Twan.
Yeah, Lil Twan. So, I mean, he's sitting there talking about, like, you need to be fucking with me now, because when Universal fly me out to New York, you know what I'm saying, you're going to have to fuck with me. I said, yeah, Universal, right? Hold on a second. So I hit my man Rap. I said, Rap, what actually y'all signing out of Pittsburgh? They said, none. So I showed him the phone. I said, so you want to say that again? He was like, nah, this is through Republic. I said, dude, this man is the A&R for Universal. He was like, oh. Well, could you at least try and listen to it? Nah, dog, you take this CD with you. Hold on, you going to lie to me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Now I call you to the car, but now you want me to listen to somebody. Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah.
So now, I mean, I'm upset because he lied to me.
Yeah.
That shit, I mean, that shit kills me. I'm just, dog, I done called many motherfuckers in the car. I'm like, dog, don't sit there and feed me. You know what I mean? Just like that night when I hit you. You know what I'm saying? I was like, yo, I ain't know y'all was even chopping with Capital. You like, nah. And I screenshotted
that. Yeah, you know what, you know, my partner Tony Draper, man, you know,
Draper's a vet.
He'll be having conversations with everybody.
Right.
And then he'll call me like about a week, like, yo, man, like, I just had a conversation with such and such. Because you know, he had Cube sign. He had Ice Cube sign through Capital. It was a, it's like, there's a label. Actually, it was one of Capital.
Navarre.
Okay. Navarre was their one of their independents. Tony Draper and Robert Redd. Robert Redd was an executive at Capitol.
Okay.
And that's Tony Draper's partner.
Right.
At Cube Vision.
Right. Okay.
You understand what I'm saying?
Last time I chopped it up with Draper, go back to the underground days.
I just talked to him this morning, actually.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. That's when he had Tila
and all
the
motherfuckers. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And, exactly. But yeah, but you know, like, he
pull a lot of strings behind the scenes, dog.
Especially with Cube. Like, that's his right hand man.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
I didn't know he was fucking with Cube that heavy.
Listen, man. Yeah. Yeah. That's where I went to the Straight Outta Compton premiere with me, Tony Draper, and Raphael Sadiq.
Okay.
And that's whose house we always at.
Is that Raphael?
We always at Raphael. They do a lot of work together. Okay. Raphael actually. His engineer is from Pittsburgh. His name is Steve, white boy from out St. Clair, Upper St. Clair. His name is Steve, man. That's Raphael's engineer. You know what I mean? So, you know, we went over there for him. And he had mixed down like two of Asco's records. You understand what I'm saying? And you know, we was over there. Well, I'm always over there, but at this particular time, it was Raphael, remember the DJ from Trap Called Quest,
Ali?
They got a studio inside the house.
Okay.
So Raphael got a house that's like a fucking warehouse, right? On one side, he got a boxing gym and a boxing ring.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then he got like four studios on the other side, And in that studio, you got the bathrooms, and you got like three bedrooms in that motherfucker. Right. But he got a group right now called, and y'all can look this up, man, because these dudes is hot, and I'm about to start trying to help promote them. Right. They called the Smashing Hearts.
Smashing Hearts.
It's Raphael's nephews. It's Dwayne's sons. His brother Dwayne. Okay, yeah. All right. It's his sons.
Yeah.
It's two of his sons, and
they say.
Yeah. They have.
Well, see, that's what I'm saying. It's
they live in their basement,
so I know and how they do.
Listen, bro. Listen, it was. Listen, we all went over there. One day, we all went over there just to go fuck around. It was me, Asco, Asco's cousin Gil's manager,
right?
And it was a couple of us, man. But we all went over Raphael's crib,
right?
And, everybody was over there that night, man. All right, in the studio and Smashing Hearts, they was over there, like. Rehearsing.
Right.
Listen, man. They remind you of a younger Tony.
Oh, man. But that sounds fresh, though.
But they got like a more rock edge type.
Right.
Listen, man. These dudes is hot, man.
I'm about to book it. Like, they got this shit up
there? Yeah, I'm going to show you something.
Okay.
They call Smashing Hearts, man. They look just like Raphael.
look like two sons.
Right? But then it's like five of them. It's two, okay. It's two white boys, one on the guitar, right. One on the drums. And then they got a DJ, Blakk dude. You know what I'm saying? He on the machines and shit.
Okay.
And it's him. It's the lead singer. But all of them got guitars, man.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to show you this shit.
Well, shit, because, shit, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, they possibly was on the guitar. Yeah, but then again, they all learned instruments.
Yeah,
they all did.
These are the guys who go on tour with Raphael. He got his nephews as his...
Wow, but that's a win.
Yeah, keeping it in the family.
Yeah.
Yeah, here they go right here. Matter of fact, this is one of the studios. This is one of the sessions that we was in.
Okay.
That's them right there.
Smashing Hearts.
These dudes is hot. That's the DJ. That's the nephew. That's Dwayne's son.
Okay.
And that's Dwayne's son. Yeah. Got a hairstyle like this.
Hey!
But I fuck with them. Look at my little niggas, man. That's Raphael's studio. That's Studio A right there.
Okay.
That's the A studio right there.
I hear this popping in D.C.
Yeah.
I hear D.C. fucking with this heaven.
They working. Raphael bullshitting on dropping they shit. You know what I'm saying? He trying to groom them first.
Right.
They getting impatient, though. You understand what I'm saying?
As most artists do.
Like, they don't understand organization, man. Like, they see all these dudes just making records and just putting them out.
Right.
And they want to follow suit. But Raphael, old school with it.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. And artists. You know what I'm saying? And helping them manage.
Yeah.
So when they pop, they blow.
The dudes, man, they hot. They look hot,
yeah,
though, man.
I know. Yes.
Yeah.
No battle. Smashing Hearts.
Yeah, it's called the Smashing Hearts.
I'm going to fuck with them.
Yeah.
Okay.
Next time I spend
I'll come check you out down
there. I'm play that shit.
Yeah, they hot, man. They got another little video.
I'll bring him down there.
But dude, he look okay. He reminds me of Prince in this video, man. I'm going to show you this shit. Yeah, man, he reminds you of Prince and shit in this video, man. And I told him about that shit. I said, man, what you trying to do? You Prince, you know what I mean?
Channel the Prince.
Actually, is this the one? Yeah, this is it. Yeah, man. That's Dwayne's son, man. Him and his brother. I'm fucking with him. You know what I'm saying? They only like 17, 18, though. They young boys.
Man, listen. At this stage of the game, they grew up in it.
Mm-hmm.
And they pure with it.
Yeah.
So to me, that's key.
And it's mad if the white boy on the Saturday, yeah. He be throwing down, man. Like, he be throwing down for real.
He goes in.
Yeah, he be on that, he be up, yo, he man. Throws down. Man, especially listen. In rehearsal.
Yeah.
Like, he be going, because they all in rehearsal, what Raphael do is, like, remember the first video I showed you?
Right.
Like, in Studio A, say that we all right here.
Right.
All that is a big-ass mirror. And what he do is he make them perform in front of a mirror because he want them to see themselves at all times.
Yeah, see what they look like. Absolutely.
You understand what I'm saying? Absolutely. And he make them perform in front of the mirror.
That's key. That's you know key. Because you get a chance to see yeah. whether you're looking awkward
yeah, or not. So if he hear one note that's slightly off, cut it.
Yep.
Redo the whole shit.
Yeah.
Like, they be mad them motherfuckers, listen, man. Bro.
You know what I mean? You know got an uncle that's a perfectionist
like, dude,
and a track history.
Shit, man.
Yeah,
he got
to rep to hold up.
You know? And listen, I listen to a lot of his shit to this day.
Yeah.
And the shit that he did is astounding.
Man, listen, man, them dudes is dope.
Yeah, Smash the Hearts. Listen, hold up. That first one you played, that shit ready to go now. Like I said, I can go down to DC and play that shit now. Motherfuckers will rush the stand like, yo, who is this and can I get that?
Yeah, I'm actually flying. You know, Raphael, he live in L.A.
Yeah.
He don't live in Elko.
Oh, he out of the Bay?
They been moved to L.A.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But every time I'm out there, that's where I'm at. I got a crib in L.A.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But, sure. Like, Raphael's crib is the crib, like, John Legend be over here.
Yeah.
Like, everybody be over
it's
here.
It's the collective.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, man, you go over there, man, you'll find anybody in there, man. They just chilling, smoking their weed.
Right.
Smoke their weed. They be chilling, and Raphael behind the motherfucker, he'll grab his little acoustic guitar, start plucking the strings, and they'll just start creating music.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? Coming up with hooks for songs, and you know what I'm saying? Right. Like, the whole atmosphere is just, it's a vibe. The girl, Jaguar White, she up, right?
Yeah, she's still fucking
with him. Always over there. She always over there.
Because I ain't heard.
Man, she always, she be helping him write.
I ain't heard nothing from her.
Man, listen, they
yeah,
last time
I heard was,
you know what I'm saying?
Jay-Z Unplugged.
All they do is write.
Shit. Yeah.
They be
well, I mean, that's the money. That's where the money is.
Yeah, by the same. You know what I'm saying? That's long paper.
That's the other thing, too, is that there's all these people who want to be rappers in Pittsburgh don't realize the shit, the rapper makes the least amount of money in the industry.
All day long.
You know? I tell dudes all the time, man, I always tell these dudes that I'm pitching some of their hooks. I said, I'm pitching some of y'all hooks, man. For other people, man.
Right.
Other songs, man.
Right.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Just start, I tell my artists all the time, man, just start coming up with hooks, man.
I still remember when Emmy took
just start all coming up with hooks
to write for Drake. They was writing for Drake.
Start coming up with hooks, man. Coming up with hooks. You know what I mean? Start writing for other people. Like, man, I got my own publishing arm. You understand what I'm saying? I said, listen, man, this publishing thing, that's what we going with.
That's money.
Exactly.
That's what we going with. You understand what I'm saying? Like, we going to be writing for other people.
Right. That's the meat.
That's what it's at.
That's the meat.
That's real.
You know what I'm saying? Get them star ghost
right. Yeah, man, because this rap shit, like, come on, man. You know what I'm saying?
Like, I mean, kind of ain't the same, man. That's the bottom of the barrel shit, though, right there.
Hey, man, my whole thing is, when I created Raw Entertainment, it was just like, yo, it's an entertainment company. Music is going to be just an arm.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I got shit I'm trying to put together right now. Screenwriters, man. You know, I'm trying to put some shit together right now. Me and Tony Draper's son. You understand what I'm saying?
Right,
like, you know, because he a film director. He write and put movies together.
Well, I mean, if he fucking with you, dude, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So what we're trying to do, I'm trying to put this shit together right now called The Feds. Alright, it's like The Wire.
Mm.
I'm trying to put that together right now. I'm trying to put together right now three comedy movies, man.
Yeah.
They ain't bootleg, they gonna be quality, but they gonna be independent film.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Because I mean right now there's so many outlets for content.
Look.
Absolutely.
You know? Man. I mean, you see Dave Chappelle just dropped two.
See that app right there?
Yeah.
That's Raw Entertainment, man. You know what I'm saying? And, right. I'm, and what I'm trying to do is, you know, I'm trying to load my app up with content.
As you should.
Content.
Just drop the app.
Because he told me, he sent it to me.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's what I'm trying to do. Like load your app up with content.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And then, you know, I already got a company that's ready to market and globalize the shit.
Right.
It's time to go, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, this music thing,
it's just a...
Music's a house, dog.
It's a catapult.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, it's literally... You know, because, when you sit there and you think about it, man, it's like, nobody is really selling. Just keeping it phone. Nobody's really
making money out of their music.
Especially off records. Music sales. Giving away free. I mean, Hef sends me fucking music. He sent me Drake's new music. He sent me Rick Ross's new music. Anytime something drops, I get it for free anyway. So I know that ain't nobody really paying for music anymore.
You use music to create a tour, to create merchandise. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's where you want to make your money at.
Yeah,
but you ain't selling records, man. Mm-hmm. You ain't selling records.
Yeah,
you know, you might sell a couple, or especially now with people signing up for these
streaming services.
These streaming services.
Yeah.
Come on, man. You ain't even gonna be selling a record for 99 cents in a minute.
Yeah, other with the shit that they don't pay. You know what I'm saying? Like the streaming services, they pay the fucking artists.
Oh yeah, yeah. I mean,
you know, so that shit is worse than a regular hard contract.
Oh yeah,
on Spotify. For 5 million streams, how much you get, like $5,000 or some shit?
I think it's less than that.
It's less than I'm just guessing.
I'm just guessing.
I'm not
It's something ridiculous though.
Nah, you know what I'm saying? It's like, what's his face? Pharrell, damn, they had a million.
Yeah.
And only got a check for what, 2,700? Some shit like that?
Yeah.
Man,
that's crazy.
Trust me, man. There is literally when it comes to money, but this is why the music don't have a shelf life now. This is why it's hot this morning and over by this, you know what I'm saying, by the night.
Yeah.
Because they're not selling. So these people don't have nothing to hold on to.
That's why artists need to think beyond
music. You got to be bigger than music.
And if you're an executive and you get in the game, you have to think beyond music.
Why don't you stream this, bro?
We ain't even got started.
Yeah,
we gotta think beyond music.
Absolutely.
Because you ain't making a willy off.
Nah.
CD's about to be obsolete.
Yeah.
They pretty much are.
Man, listen. Yeah. The album, how Joe Budden said the shit 6 years ago. The album is an urban legend. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So we sit there and talk about platinum plaques and albums and shit. Okay, cool. Drake will drop out every now and then, but when the last time Drake went gold or platinum?
Yeah.
They ain't cut no plaques for him.
Yeah.
The last person that went platinum since J. Cole's most recent album was J. Cole with his last album.
Yeah.
Kendrick was not platinum.
Yeah.
Kendrick was only gold.
Yeah.
But because the standards are so shitty with record sales, they said, well, fuck it, gold is the new platinum. You can't do that.
Yeah.
That's not how the game works. Yeah. That's why his manager went public, said, listen, Kendrick is my artist. I love that man. That's my dude. He didn't sell a million copies. He ain't platinum.
Yeah.
Get over it. Platinum is a million.
Yeah.
That's what it is. Let's stick to the script.
Yeah, I'm curious to see the next time somebody approaches Diamond.
Oh, that'll never happen.
Why do you think so many artists, like, you got dudes coming out the gate that ain't even been out a whole fucking month. You know what I mean? Getting $10,000 a show. Mm-hmm. Yep. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Right.
Like you try to book some of these artists right now that's just bubbling on the underground mixtapes and shit right now.
Yeah.
Niggas that the mainstream ain't nobody ever even heard of.
Right.
Man, you call these niggas managers or you look on their Instagram and you contact somebody. Talking about motherfucking $7,500 for a motherfucker who nobody know.
Because I hit up to see about bringing Dreezy in, and they were like 10 G's plus, you know, transportation, room and board, and you know, the writer was ridiculous. I'm like,
right.
And this was like probably 6 months ago, before the jam dropped with Gucci, you know, and she still wanted 10 G's.
But this is the only way these artists can make their money.
Yeah,
that's it. Because there is no other money for
you. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah,
like merchandise. Like Chance the Rapper, he killing them.
Oh yeah.
He killing them on merch. That's why you have to be smart.
Yeah.
And you gotta be particular about what you put out, how you put out, your image and everything.
Yeah,
like a lot of these artists don't understand it. And they think that you can just jump out the gate. They want to do what everybody else is doing.
Yes.
All these artists who don't have a shelf life, who ain't got longevity.
Right.
Or if they've been out here a long time, you understand, their stock is dwindling.
Yeah.
They're losing value.
A lot of them have, they already have their fan base. Mm-hmm. Their fan base isn't growing. All they got to do is keep making music.
Keep making music. And
to support their fan base.
And, right. You know? And merch, just create merchandise.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And going for, you know, like, going for these sponsorship and endorsement deals.
Absolutely.
That's where the money is. So that's why you want to create the image that is non-threatening. You understand? You want to create the best image for yourself that you can create. Because you when they look at you, if Sprite is looking at you, if Hennessy is looking at you, if any sponsor is looking at you, you want them to be able to say, okay, well, I can sell him over here. I can sell him over here. Okay, so he's worth $5 million.
Yeah,
I can give him $5
million.
Yeah, right. You understand what I'm saying? But, you know, so it's always a good, and I always encourage artists, man, yo, go to fucking etiquette classes. Take some etiquette courses.
Yeah.
So that when you're dealing with the media, you understand, you ain't, y'all mean.
Yeah.
Exactly. You know what I'm saying? You ain't talk.
Right. That's why I do this, so that
you understand an artist what I'm saying?
Can say that they sat down and been interviewed before. Right. Before they actually get interviewed and look like dude on the news, you know, the nigga they always find on the news to talk. That's what they look like. Because you know, they you can have a bunch of Blakk boys standing around, they're going to be like, oh yeah, you picking out the garbage, come here, we want to talk to you. You know, they don't look to promote us in a positive light, any place.
So you have to promote yourself.
But I mean, but the killer part is, like, one of the biggest things I always tell these artists, man, is like, because everybody is hustling for the deal.
Yeah.
And I told him, I said, listen, the deal nowadays is nothing like what it used to be.
No.
I said, the deal, wrong. The deal nowadays is the brand new fub job. A 360 deal? So that means, listen, you know, it's the proverbial Frank White shit. A nickel bag is sold in the park, I want in. And that's what these deals are.
Yeah.
So, I mean, a lot of cats is grinding and like, okay, cool. So Lil Yachty did the Sprite commercial. Oh, that Sprite commercial all over the place. From ESPN to fucking Cartoon Network.
They did Target commercial, too. Because they remade...
It Takes Two.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, that in of itself was a travesty, but we'll get to that.
I know.
But he signed up. What's the label he signed to?
Is he on Epic?
I was about to say Epic.
Yeah.
So Epic is good at all that shit.
Yeah.
Now, when Chance the Rapper did the Kit Kat shit, who got paid?
Chance.
Yeah.
Fucking A.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like my man, like Lil Prop, love Prop. Listen, I understand he up to talking to these labels and shit like that, and I'm saying it because I'm here, and he can go back and watch the shit, but I told him, I said, dog, you hustling to hustle backwards. Stop worrying about these motherfucking labels, dog. You are the fucking label.
You the label.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
And what you do is you get out here and you keep grinding and you create leverage.
There you go.
You create leverage for yourself and for your company, and you make them come to you.
Yeah, absolutely.
You make them bow down to you. Absolutely. You ain't fuck you contacting
big reps.
Man, you make them, because once you make the noise,
they're coming. They're coming.
They're coming to you.
Yeah.
They're coming.
And when they come to you, see, anything, any type of business, when you create the leverage, you control the negotiations.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
You don't need them. They need you.
No, you need me. So you come to me and say, this is what I want.
Yeah.
Right. All right. Now, in any business, okay, you negotiate to where it's going.
You know,
both of y'all happy. Yeah. You understand what I'm saying? But more so, I'm going to get what I want.
Yeah.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? So, and I encourage any artist, any executive out there, if you got a company and a stable artist, you understand? Create leverage.
Absolutely.
Go out there and work. Bust your ass. Yeah, it's going to cost you a few dollars. You understand what I'm saying? But I'm looking for longevity, not just a quick buck.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? I'm looking for longevity,
for a career,
not just a quick buck.
Absolutely.
And I ain't going for a situation where the motherfucker going to control everything I built.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And tell me what the fuck they going to do with mine and give me.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, tell you your percentage of your
so
shit.
So, fuck, no.
That's
so
like,
so you just create, you gotta work, create that leverage. That's why you gotta make sure that everything is on point, man, and that you got everything they want and need.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
You You understand what I'm saying? Definitely. Like you can't be out here half stepping, create a song, you wanna throw it out on YouTube, put it on Facebook, and you understand what I'm saying? Just to say you popping in the city.
Yeah. Right.
They don't give a fuck about
Meanwhile, the city, you know, Pittsburgh don't give a fuck about nobody. Listen. Until you blow elsewhere.
Right.
And then you can come back. Mm-hmm. And then once you get successful, they're still going to talk shit on you.
Of course.
You know? That's our city.
Man, the one, I still remember when I was working for WAMO, the last phone call that I got from a major label about a Pittsburgh artist, no bullshit, Sharon Don.
Okay,
You know what I'm saying? Now, you know, Sharon, mad lyrical, crazy. Yeah. Problem is, he didn't have the right people around him to even reach him.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, Sharon, he an artist to the head and heart, which means he float however the wind blow.
Yeah.
But he needs somebody like you that's grounded, that can catch the call and say, listen,
take care of the business.
Exactly. You know what I'm saying? My man Sammy Crespo. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. He's still doing
business. He's still Atlantic Records?
Huh?
He said Atlantic?
He was Atlantic, and last I checked, he was an A&R.
Yeah.
Who was?
Sammy Crespo. Yeah. So he called, he's like, yo, what you know about this kid, Sharon Don? I said, well, he crazy lyrical. If you put ink to him, you won't be disappointed.
Yeah.
Pittsburgh, you know what I mean? Man, I'm gonna tell you something, man. Pittsburgh got so many dope artists, man.
Yeah.
Listen.
Like, we got a fucking gold mine in Pittsburgh. And I'm talking about in every genre of music.
Yeah. Right?
On every level of hip-hop, whether it's the trap rap, whether it's the backpack
the
rap,
right.
Conscious. Yeah. Like, we got every
and singers too.
Thing we need.
Yeah, yeah.
But we,
you understand what I'm saying? R&B.
We literally powered
soul.
The West Coast sound for years.
Yeah, I tell people that all the time that, you know, that the West Coast sound is really the Pittsburgh.
That's us.
That's Pittsburgh.
You know what I'm saying? That's Sneed. That's Butter. That's Mel. That's us.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That shit is ours. Yeah. And I mean, like, I always had this discussion. Anybody that's from the Hill or knows Mailman Sound knows he made Phone Tap.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, yeah. Point blank. Everybody know.
In the Hill, man. I remember. Listen, I'm going to tell you something. I remember, nigga, when I was a kid. I remember when NBL used to pop lock and break dance.
Facts.
Kid R. Phil. It was NBL, Janie Beck.
Yes,
NBL, Janie Beck. Larry, what's his name? We used to do Michael Jackson all the time.
Larry,
you understand what I'm saying? Like all these niggas, man.
Right.
Man, they used to just... Man, they used to battle up Kid R. Phil. They used to bring the battles up Kid R. Phil.
Yeah.
Sliding across the floor, doing a snake across the floor and shit, man.
Hell yeah.
Like, NBL was always into entertainment.
Oh, yes.
That was his shit.
Oh.
That was his life.
Right.
From as far as I knew it, like, I grew up under them.
Yeah, yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? But he was always ripping, rapping, ripping on people.
Yeah.
Exactly. That was his thing.
Beating people up. You understand what I'm saying? Like, he was always, like... He was always entertaining.
But the one thing that Mel did, like Mel and even Tuffy, you know what I'm saying, did, which was unheard of. Now, Mel sold Mailman Delivers. At first, when he first dropped his solo.
What was that? The crew got paid, crew got caught.
Well, no, that was hardcore shit.
Yeah, okay.
But when he did, that's the Mailman, the Malfunction.
Yeah, the Mailman.
You know what I'm saying? All that shit was on
Baby
that.
Baby Ain't Mine.
Exactly.
That
so that tape, out the blocks.
Hard to say goodbye.
Yeah, exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
He sold 10,000 copies of the tape.
Damn.
Hold up. So he goes back. Now it's starting to transition over to CDs.
Yeah.
So now he re-releases it on CD, sell another 10,000 of those.
Damn.
The labels came. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
20,000 by itself?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, he made too much noise.
Yeah.
We need in. Because you figure 20,000, he was hitting what? About 10 a pop?
You know what? I don't know, man. I got my tape. I'm going to tell you what I did, man. Like, I was a little young nigga, man. Wow, man. I stole my tape out of the what's her name store? Down on Center Avenue.
You talking about
remember they had that little store on the corner? Like, we had the Five and Dime. And then remember, what's her name? The lady that had the store, the little record store on the corner.
Yeah, right, I should have been there that long, but yeah.
I wasn't there long.
You guys listen about it, man. Listen, he sold that shit all over the city, though. You know what I'm saying? Now, Mel was always fighting out of the Coliseum when it was still a skating rink. and was selling his tape in Homewood, though.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it was, I mean, he did big numbers. And then when Tuffy sold like 9,500 of that EP that had Ghetto Soundcheck on it, then they made Billboard. Most people didn't know that they was in Billboard magazine.
Yeah.
And then, so the article spoke about the 20,000 units that Mel sold, the almost 10,000. Now, mind you, Tuffy primarily released Ghetto Soundcheck on vinyl. I can't think of 10,000 motherfuckers that got turntables.
Yeah.
So to sell that many units, yeah, he was loving that shit.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then they talked about the Homeboy White Tape movement. So now you're talking about F3, Smash, yeah, E-Order. They were talking about all that shit.
Chris Lowe and all that.
Exactly. But they were talking about this shit in Billboard magazine. So they was making international press.
That's crazy.
Selling units, though.
Yeah. No,
man. Exactly.
Don't no, nobody know that, though. Like, the generation now does not know that.
No.
Because, like,
they know.
Like my introduction to Pittsburgh hip-hop, I was talking about still, was Two Brothers Deep. Yeah. My man Sean Daniels
and
Ron Hendricks from Two Brothers Deep. That's my boy. And Sean was my DJ mentor, and he's from the Hill. So that's my introduction to Pittsburgh hip hop. And they were actually managed by B. Marshall's dad. Brandon Marshall's dad was their manager.
Okay.
And so they were doing shows in New York, Webster's Hall, coming back and forth. I think the one time I seen them open for Foo Schnicks. In Oakland one time.
Yeah, they did.
Yeah,
they did.
So that's my introduction to Pittsburgh hip hop. Once I got into that, I was like, I gotta be involved somehow. And my introduction, like my thing was video. You know, I was at the Cyphers and videotaping the B-Boys and Cyphers and we used to go to Club Lager. And right. They were like, we should do a show. I was like, okay. You know, I mean, I've never done a show before. And they were like, why don't you help Boca? So, I mean, I knew Fred because he went to school out here.
Right.
You know, so I went to him and we went and found, you know, 10 artists and that was our first show 20 years ago. You know, and we've been doing it ever since.
Right.
So, when I see these artists nowadays and these promoters nowadays talking about how trying to tell me how I should do a show or pay to play is wrong or, like, half of them were, like, 6 and 7 years old when I did my first show. How the fuck are you going to tell me how to do a show? Let me see you do a show with no internet.
Right.
Take away all social media and do a show. Never happened.
Well, see, the killer part about it is nowadays, a motherfucker ain't got to pay to get into your shit because somebody going to fucking Facebook Live and they can watch that shit from their couch.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They getting a fucking $35 show for nothing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Nowadays, it's real, but it's the industry has changed.
Yeah.
And the fact that they, you know what I mean? If you don't do your history to know where it came from, you won't understand where the fuck it's gone.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
That's the problem
here. Yeah, I mean, it went from being able to cake from the music and then pivot that heavy, you know what I'm saying? Because now, if you sell gold, you know what I'm saying, back then, shit, well, who are you? Okay, back.
Yeah.
Let's get, you know what I'm saying? Let's get with you. So now we got opportunities. Heaven off the world if you want platinum.
Yeah.
And if you sold diamond, that means you sold to white people.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And that's real. Because, I mean, you sit there and think about, like, I had this discussion with, I forget who I was talking to. Like, we're talking about whack artists. When, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. When did it stop being socially acceptable to say, listen, man, that shit weak, dog.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? When? So, and everybody was like, well, there's always been whack artists. I said, yeah. I said, and listen, Hammer and Vanilla Ice was labeled as two of the wackest.
Uh-huh.
However, each of them got diamond albums, so at least 10 million people said, fuck out of here.
Yeah.
We don't think they whack.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. So, nowadays, you got artists that they love. Like, I mean, I can say, you can pick any name from today. It don't fucking matter. From your 21 Savages to your Migos to whoever.
Yeah.
And they listening to this shit in heavy rotation, but they not buying them.
Yeah.
And the killer part about it is because these motherfuckers are not even putting out albums, you mean to tell me your favorite artist ain't even worth 99 cents? So how much do you like them?
Yeah. That's why music's so disposable nowadays.
Exactly.
You know? You'll be on the charts.
That's the shelf life that we was talking about.
To go back to what you just said about MC Hammer and Vanilla Ice, man. You know, I always tell artists, man, stand out and be different.
And they were.
Yeah.
Stand out and be different. Because if you pay attention to every artist that everybody called weird, pointed with that tone low, Young MC,
yeah.
All these motherfuckers made millions.
Yes, they did.
Yeah.
Yes,
it was
they did.
The niggas was calling them corny, cornballs. Man, they weakest at all these motherfuckers was making money. More yep. money than all these.
And all of them right now can still go out and make money touring. Okay. All of them, they still do.
Because they are. They are. They're all of them. You just, all the ones you just named is literally on. They
I love the 90s tour.
There you go.
Yeah.
Like, you know
what
I'm saying?
All these motherfuckers are still making money.
Yeah.
And on their records, you know what I'm saying? Their records are still, you know, they still getting royalties.
Absolutely. Yeah.
They still getting
these
royalties.
These artists don't know nothing about it because they don't get the sales in the first place.
They still getting royalties, man.
Right.
They still getting royalty right. money.
Right.
Yeah.
And they got records that, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead, man.
They still got, they got records that you can listen to 20 years from when they, like them songs is what, 20, 25
yeah.
years
yeah.
ago?
Yeah.
And they still making money off those records.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
You're not going to hear Lil Yachty's music in the next 4 to 5 years.
4 to 5 years? Yeah. The next 4 to 5 months?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's true.
Right.
That's true.
You
it's about longevity.
Because, and they don't have that. I mean, but that's the difference between the now versus good music. Because you can go, good music has a memory attached to that shit.
Yeah.
Like, yo, first time I heard this, I was at, where was you at the first time you heard The Crew Got Paid?
I was on punishment. I was on punishment at home on Borough Street, man.
Exactly.
I was on punishment, man. And my cousin, was it my cousin Darius or who was my cousin? Somebody, I feel right. Me fucked. But I stole one of their little tapes. You know what I'm saying? Because remember that little radio station and shit? I think it was a Pitt University.
WUPTS, that's where I come from.
97.1 or some shit. You know what I'm saying? Listen, man. I stole one of their tapes, and I was in my bed with somebody. Cassette tape.
Yeah.
And remember, I used to put the toilet paper in the top of the
yes, sir. The table broke out. Yeah, man.
And listen, I used to record that radio station.
Yep.
Press record, and I used to listen to, they used to play everything.
Absolutely.
And that's how I first heard that shit.
That's where the fuck I come from. The first time I heard that shit was before I actually got to Pitt to get into that radio station. I got the tape.
Listen.
I still got the tape from when I first heard it. I recorded that bitch. And I still got that.
I used to listen to that radio like every Saturday or Sunday or something.
Yeah, it was Friday.
Every Friday. Well, I
every Friday.
Okay,
yeah.
I was
it was once a week.
Yeah.
Punish me.
Yeah.
I used to listen to that shit. Yeah.
Seriously. That's the realest shit in the world, though, man.
That's no punishment, man. Yeah.
Literally. Because I mean,
first time somebody's tape.
Yeah.
Yeah, I used to sit, because my mom and them was on, everybody in my family, all my aunts and uncles, everybody was into music heavy. They had every album, every tape of my cousins, Darius, my cousin Renee, Minifield, you know what I'm saying? She had every album, every record, every CD, every tape cassette. I used to just go stealing everybody's shit. I used to be stealing everybody's shit. If I was in your car and you had a CD or a tape, nigga, I was getting you for that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I was taking that shit. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So, and I would take, I used to take people's shit and I used to record over it.
Oh, damn.
Okay,
you know what I'm saying?
That's what
I used to do. I used to write my own songs to other people's songs.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, I used to listen to other people's song, and then I would write my own song to they shit.
Yep.
I was notoriously like, yo, let me get this, bro. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I would always get that.
Like, real, man.
Real shit. Because like I was telling you, that, like, when I met Sean D, because I was, like, around my senior year in high school, and my freshman year at Pitt, you know what I'm saying? Sean was mixing with, like, the Philly cats was running shit at this point. They was running shit down WPTX. So they had it on lock. It was the Punk Funk Nation, so... Then all of them was from Philly. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And Donna Baxter, Lady Fresh, was the only female in the crew.
Miss Vincent,
You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? But before that, she used to wear the big bangles and the long leather, the trench leather.
Yeah.
And she was killing shit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So they was down there and Sean was mixing with them. Now, mind you, they had the radio station on Smash. Everybody in the city was listening to that shit on Fridays. They had the pit parties on Smash. You know, I'm like, yo. And Sean was mixing with them. I'm like, yo, I need parts.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to get on. I'm trying to get in. And at the time, I was strictly spitting and learning how to DJ.
Yeah.
So it's like, yo, I got to battle somebody. Sean was there.
Nick Nice is trying to call me. Okay, man, I gotta call him back.
Right. He's
gonna teach me how to DJ.
Okay.
Nick Nice gonna teach me how to DJ.
Yeah. Good shit. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? It's the truth.
I'm getting Nick Nice to teach me how to DJ.
I got the attention because I battled Sean and I won. Now, at this point, I was battling down low, up on Cliff and all that shit. I was down there battling.
Yeah.
Coming from Francis. So I'm battling niggas in the hood. You know what I'm saying? They're like, okay, I ain't know you got it. Yeah. I took that shit to bit. Like, oh, I'm sawing. I get in.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Do I got to battle every MC you got in order to get in, or can I get in?
Yeah.
You know, so I fought, and I got on this radio. Yeah. But the thing about it is I researched it. You know what I'm saying? I researched Nick Nice. Nick, most people don't know Nick was a battle DJ back then. You know what I mean? Nick was a monster with that shit. I mean, do you figure at this point, this is 23-year-old Nick Nice. You know what I mean? So he's doing tricks, standing on his head, under his arm, through his, you know what I'm saying, twisting, contorting. Mm-hmm. He's a fucking animal. He was a battle DJ.
Yeah.
Most people didn't know that shit. So I'm studying him. Of course, I'm studying under Mel Plow and God Bless.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? He the OG. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Only other person I look to above Mel. The Sly Jock.
Yeah.
Sly Jock said all this shit.
Yeah.
If you didn't go to high school with a Sly Jock tape. Exactly. If you ain't go to school.
At one point, that's your only dose of hip hop. That's the only time you get
to listen to hip-hop. He was the rapper of Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Literally, his shit came on Sunday night graveyard.
Yeah.
I would go to school Monday morning. Red eye like the cushion on this motherfucking mic. But I had the fresh tape.
Yeah.
Fresh tape.
And you know what I'm talking about. That shit was real. Yeah. So I studied these cats. And I'm like, okay, I took notes from everything that they did right. And then the things that I would do different once I got in that position.
Yeah.
So when I hit the ground at WBTS, in like October of 90, I hit the ground running. But I got, not only did I get thrown on the radio, I got thrown into the industry.
Yeah.
Because I became a director of the station. So now I'm making these phone calls. I didn't know these promo people doubled as the A&R. Okay. Because in some labels, they were different.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Some, and like in Priority's case. Q's original label.
Yeah. Priority was independent.
Exactly. But the owner was the A&R. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, a lot of labels was independent.
Yeah, that's one less person to pay.
They had multiple roles.
Absolutely.
They wore different hats.
Absolutely. So I get there, not only do I get on air in a prime time, and the station is already hot, but now I'm making connections out of state. So it became this big deal. I'm studying, I'm taking everything I've learned from these motherfuckers. I'm like, oh, shit.
Network, man.
This shit is big.
That's what it's about. You got a network.
Yeah.
Right. Because literally, Pitt only paid for one trip out of town. No, I lied. Two. The rest was paid for by the labels. So I was spending an ass load of time in New York on Def Jam's channel, on Big Beat's channel, which was a subsidiary of Atlantic.
Yeah.
One of the many.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I was on RCA's channel. I was always in New York.
Yeah.
And I never had to come out of pocket because they paid for everything. But these are the things that a lot of these cats don't do. They don't get. They don't go to these conferences and network. And then here, this is my favorite. Here, they're so dismissive, like they're Kobe in the league. But this shit.
Pride and ego.
This shit is still street ball. You understand what I'm saying? It's still 100% street ball.
They will never understand it.
Because the killer part about it is you will dismiss a motherfucker that you don't know is connected. Yeah. You don't know who they're connected to.
Yeah.
Like, that's, to me, that's just the dumbest thing in the world.
Yeah.
Pride and ego is a motherfucker.
That is sad.
Pride and ego will kill you quick.
Dead.
You understand? You will be the hottest artist on the fucking planet, man. And sooner or later, man, people won't get sick of your shit.
Yeah.
They won't get sick. You know what I'm saying? And that's another thing.
Because they build you up to bring you down.
Like I say, longevity is the key. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And you got to remain humble. You got to remain focused. And you got to remain hungry.
Yeah.
You can't get lazy once you get popping.
Yeah.
And start thinking, oh, well, I'm that nigga now.
Somebody's
coming for that spot. And there's going to be somebody out there that can hurt you, that hate your motherfucking gut simply because of your motherfucking ego.
Yeah, because of your success.
Just because it's not even because of his success. Yeah, so they probably supported the success until they realize how egotistical you are.
Yeah.
Exactly. You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. So that pride and ego always tell me, if you're an artist, man, you the one everybody got to like.
Yeah.
Right.
Absolutely. You have to remain likable.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You ain't gotta be the type that, you know, try to please everybody.
Yeah.
You understand what I mean? By kissing everybody's ass or whatnot.
Right.
But you have to remain likable.
Yeah.
There's certain things that you got to do.
Right.
To stay away from the bullshit.
Yeah.
Right.
You got an image to protect. You got an image to keep up.
Right.
Yeah.
That's why I tell artists, man, don't put an image out there that ain't yours.
Yeah. Facts. Because somebody's gonna check it.
Because it's too easy. But if you out there crying and stunting, it's way too easy to get exposed. It's way too easy to get exposed.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, definitely.
Too easy to get exposed if you out there stunting, front perpetrating this shit.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, one of the things that, one of the reasons I want to talk to both of y'all is, one, because I need to know how underground hip hop started. And then also, I need to know how Raw Entertainment started, because as far as the music industry goes in the city, Raw Entertainment is the only label besides Rostrum that I know of that's a real label that, like, will pay, like, artists have a budget. You know, you would pay for stuff. You pay for artists' clothes, their hair, their travel. And there's people out here that say they got labels that do none of that. Don't have near the money to do anything like that.
They don't know the business.
Yeah. Yeah.
We just need to pop.
Exactly.
That's all, man.
Yeah.
Raw Entertainment, we just need to pop. And once we pop and get that ball rolling, it's a wrap, man.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, it's going to go. I've been out here too long.
Yeah.
Right. The artists I work with now, man, been out here too long. Been grinding too long, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's time to go.
You sound like me, and I ain't been going nowhere near as long as you. I said, you sound like me, and you. I ain't
but I'm going to help answer the question first.
Okay. All right. I can go with that. As far as Underground Hip Hop Video Magazine, so the show kicked off in spring of 92. And I know that much because it took them a year to catch me. But that show was started by my business partners, Adam Smith and Les Bigos. They came up with this shit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Now, anybody know them? They smoke a lot of weed.
That's Lee's brother, right?
Exactly.
Lee Smith, yeah.
Exactly. So, you know what I'm saying? They smoke a lot of weed. Probably sitting there watching TV. He's like, damn,
sugar top.
What if we did, exactly? What if we did a video show that just said, fuck everything? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They came up with the shit. So at the time, the original host, you know what I'm saying, was Lucky Williams, Gaylord.
Yeah.
And
Gaylord and Dre.
And, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying?
Them.
Yeah, man.
World Street.
Exactly. So it was Gaylord and my man Dice from the Keys.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So those were the two original hosts. You know what I'm saying? Now, literally, they was drinking 40s on air. And one of the signatures of the show was the strobe light. Every episode, Adam had his goddamn strobe light on them.
Yeah.
So my man that lived near Adam was like, at this time, I had WPTS on Smash. I was on tilt at this point.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I was literally on fire. So at this point, now I'm getting Arbitron numbers. You know what I'm saying? This is before BDS numbers.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Arbitron. I mean, yeah, but Arbitron numbers. So now I'm registered. Adam sends a message through my man like, yo, I need him on my show. He got the radio. We can put him on TV.
Let's get it. I ain't even gonna lie, this is gonna be the first time that Adam hears this, so my bad, man. I didn't believe it. It's like a TV show. I said, what's the TV show do? A video show. Like Pittsburgh? Fuck out of here. They ain't doing that shit. And my man was like, look, man, this is on PCTV, it's on Canada. I said, what the fuck is PCTV?
I
did
that shit on 21.
Absolutely. Yeah, but at the time, I had cable, knew nothing about it. So I said, all right, you know, whatever. So 6 months of hearing this, I said, all right, what channel is this shit? What channel is this shit? So he told me, it's 21. All right. So I watched the show. The first time I watched it, you know what I mean? It's grainy, it's low budget, and then PCTV wasn't optimal.
Yeah.
I was like, what the fuck is this? I said, what, you be on this? All right. Watched a couple episodes. Then I started watching the video. Wait, man. So, from 10 o'clock on, I play Cuff Shit, and they come on at 11, and they playing Cuff. Y'all need that. So, 93, I came to my first shoot, and Adam, I meet Adam, you know what I'm saying? He's like, look, man, already video show, say what you want, say it how you want. And I actually still got the videotape. That's what I said. I still got the videotape of my first appearance on Underground. He said, man, you can say whatever the fuck you want to say. Now, I'm the type of person that if you set a parameter that has no limits,
yeah,
I'm going to test your no limits.
Yeah.
Cool. He said, I can say whatever the fuck I want. Exactly how the fuck I feel like. So my first area. What the fuck is up? It's your boy Blakk, motherfucker, still on Underground, motherfucking hip hop. I'm cussing like crazy. He's like, all right, cut. Good take. I says, wait a minute. So this is going on TV? He's like, yeah, that was a good one. He's like, the show runs 2 weeks after we filmed it.
Yeah.
And I watched this shit. I was like, so I changed. I said, all right, cool. I got a vocabulary. Let me use that shit.
Yeah.
So now I started finessing. And it got to a point where I'm like, okay, we're doing the same shit like was on BET, TV at the time. I'm going to make it different. So literally, I used to freestyle my shit and would basically be rhyming, talking, dropping bars off the head because I was an MC still, too. Yeah. A lot of cats I used to rhyme with off camera. Adam was like, yo, why do I keep cutting the camera off and missing the sessions? But nonetheless, we made so much noise, we got nominated for 6 Billboard Awards.
Damn.
Yeah. Now, Adam and Les was the ones that went. I never took the trip to L.A.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Not for that. They went. Every single year that we were nominated, we lost to Ralph McDaniel's Video Music.
That was in Houston, right?
New York.
The Box. All right.
Uncle Ralph.
I remember the Box.
Yeah.
Oh, Uncle Ralph, dog. We lost to him every year. So I'm like, what the fuck? How come we keep losing to this motherfucker? Who the fuck is Uncle Ralph? Now I got to do my research on Uncle Ralph.
Yeah.
So on one of the trips that Def Jam paid for me to come up there, I was in a hotel at that time. Odd time. The shit came on in the afternoon. And I watched it.
I used to watch that shit too.
I used to watch that shit too. And I watched it. I said, okay.
The Box. Yeah.
I said, this is crazy. I said, no wonder we not bad.
That's how I got put on the Jodeci.
Yeah.
Motherfucking Box.
Yeah.
That's how I got put on the Jodeci.
Video Music Box.
91, 92.
Yeah. Video Music Box was a beast. I was like, okay, cool. We losing to Uncle Ralph. That's cool. We can live with that. But then artists was finding out what we were doing. And, like, we had the labels that was helping us.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I would call, if Adam didn't have a connect at a certain label, I use my connect at that label. Like, yo, we need a video drop from such and such and such and such. Saying, whatever the fuck you want, an R-rated video show. Boom. Some labels didn't believe, so we had to send them tapes, show them.
Yeah.
That's like Pittsburgh doing it like this. So there would be times that they would send artists just for the fucking interview.
Oh, damn.
Literally. Because, now, I don't know if y'all friends with Adam on Facebook or whatever, but but he posted a picture recently of me with the lawsuit.
Oh, I seen it. I seen it. Yeah, I seen it.
That was one of the occasions where the artists came in for the interview. They weren't performing on that track. Mm-hmm. They came for us.
Damn. You know what I mean? They went to Pittsburgh for a video show.
Yeah, I saw that picture. I seen it.
Yeah. They came to Pittsburgh for us. They came to us. Now they went to WAMO for the customary. All right, we're gonna do the commercial radio out here.
Yeah.
But they came for us.
Yeah.
RZA fucked with us heavy. He would come here for us. He came for us.
Yeah.
No performances, no Wu-Tang, other members, nowhere else. Came to Pittsburgh for us.
Yeah.
So we were notorious in the industry. Like we got a demo reel, not even a demo reel, but like a drop reel.
Yeah. It
says, who's down with the underground? It's just some of the drops. You know what I mean? And when he got Stevie Wonder at one of the Billboard Awards, he had to run out. Now, that one wasn't dirty.
Yeah, yeah.
Stevie just saying, he's like, you're watching underground hip hop. And he dropped it like that. And it was cool. You know what I mean? But we did that heavy. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. For 17 years.
And at one point, it was the longest running video show on TV, right?
Yep.
Yeah, I thought so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We are, if anybody has any shows on PCTV, we single-handedly are the reasons why they wrote a lot of those laws, about a lot of those things that you can't do, because of us. Like, if we filmed here, we wouldn't say, you know what I'm saying, yo, we got to see these popping, like, yo, big shout out to One Live Radio Hub for allowing us to shoot this episode here. Subtle advertisement.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
PCTV said, no more that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You can't say, cop that, buy that, it's for sale, etc.
Yeah.
Couldn't do it. They wouldn't allow us because
of
us. When we first started, we was getting a lot of videos from Luke. So when we went to South Beach, Luke took care of us like nobody's business. Like, because here's the wild shit. Def Jam flew me to South Beach for the How Can I Be Down. Luke got us into his exclusive party where the line wrapped around that building 3 times. Teddy Riley couldn't get into that shit.
Damn.
Adam and Les was in their VIP. I didn't want to go because the shit was too crowded. So I'm sitting there playing Sega Genesis with Easy Mo B. We was in the same hotel on the same floor. So if you're talking 95, that's what was popping at the time.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? Now, shout out to Mo B. He whooped my ass in Madden, though. But this type of shit that we was doing.
Yeah.
We, you know what I mean? Nervous paid for us to be at Mad Lion's album release party.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? We went to a lot of different places. We represented Pittsburgh well. Now, if we would have known the business a lot better, back then, that could have been so much more.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But at that particular point, we're young. We having a whole bunch of fun. I mean, we with him.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We hanging out with him.
Yeah. Yeah.
We're like, oh, this is the life. We wasn't even thinking about it. Like, the only thing we knew was we didn't have to reach in our wallet for shit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? We got drunk. We got high on him. Whatever.
Yeah.
We kicking it with them. We rubbing with the celebrities. We was at the Palladium last June.
Damn.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We in there on VIP when J. Rue and his crew stopped somebody out.
Mm.
We're there for this shit.
Yeah.
But we studied what came before. Took notes on what we didn't like. And we revamped that shit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
So whose idea was it to add the girls?
That was Adam and Les.
Really?
So here's the wild part. Like, most people don't even believe us. The hosts were never around when the girls were filmed. We never were. We weren't allowed. So what they would do is on film days, like, all right, so we shot this new underground girl. And then they would stick in the raw footage to show us. Now, of course, some of the raw footage could not make TV because it was just certain shit you just couldn't show.
Yeah.
Because we had already started rewriting PCTV laws at this point.
Yeah.
It was them. They was like, all right, we fine. You know what I mean? Now, at first, they had connects. This is where your boy Draper came in. And they had a couple connects down in Atlanta. They was filming this. You know what I'm saying? And sending them to us. So half of them was from out of town.
Oh, okay, damn. So they weren't even all local girls.
The local girls saw the out of town bro and said, man, we can do that. And they came. You know what I mean? They followed suit. So it was the wildest thing, but that was their brainchild. Yeah. So we were never on set to film. Yeah. They were like, man, we know y'all fucking strippers. No! We don't see them! We don't see them until y'all see the tape.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Now in order to protect the guilty, one of the strippers at that time was one of my man's girls. So I ended up seeing her do some extraneous shit. Now, mind you, I didn't know that was his bra.
Yeah.
I'm telling the story, some shit she did in the club when I was DJing down at Tequila Willie's. ain't too many clubs in this bitch I didn't tear down, man. I was down there tearing down, you know what I'm saying? And she had to have been like, oh, yeah, some shit. Wow, shit. So this was Friday. I come to film on Monday, and I'm telling this story. So he shows up in the middle of the story, and I'm still telling this shit. So I was like, yeah, we got this new underground girl. Her name is such and such and such. Sticks it in. It's her. I said, yo, the story I just saw, it was her. And my man was like, for real? Picked up his phone, like, yo, we done. On site. So, of course, no names dropped to protect the guilty, but you know what I mean? But this is the type of shit that we was running into.
Yeah.
Fucking around with underground.
Yeah.
It's the wildest shit. But that was Adam and Les's brainchild. That was their shit.
Yeah.
I came aboard, and what ended up happening, because how I ended up becoming the face, because I was there every week. I was hungry. And my thing was, at the time, I'm still heavy to MC.
Yeah.
I need to be seen.
Exposure.
As well as heard. And at that point, I was using both
BTS
and underground to get leverage to listen to my music.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So at that particular point, because I was talking to labels. I was talking to Mercury, and I was talking to Rick Rubin's label, American. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And with American shit, around that time, they had just signed Chino XL. Chino's a bar monster.
Yeah.
I needed to get my game up. They was funneling that into it.
Yeah.
I said, okay, fuck, I can't be mad at that. Pen to the paper, gotta write more. You know what I mean? Gotta work. But that was when it was about cultivating the artist and building the artist and things like that. Facts.
Yeah.
And that's what it was coming down to. So with Underground, that's what we did.
Yeah.
And then like when I transitioned and went to Wambo, I was going to try to incorporate that, but there was a lot of red tape that went into that. And I mean, there was a bunch of tussles that I had with Wham on a bunch of other shit that I was doing.
Yeah.
But the biggest piece of leverage that I always had within the station is, because I worked for them twice. When I got listed in Vibe as having the hottest radio show in Pittsburgh by myself, in Vibe magazine, Wham-O came. So that's 1994. I didn't ask, because I had no intention on working for them.
Yeah.
They came. I don't know how the fuck they got my phone number. Mm-hmm. They came. I left. I'm living in Atlanta for 2 years. I came back. They knew I was back before I told anybody. For 2 years, they pressed me. And
so who was pressing you? It was Ron Atkins?
He wasn't even in power at the time. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. In fact, when he came into power the first time is when I got fired. Because he didn't know me.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay. He fired me sight unseen. At that time, I was on Graveyard. They wouldn't give me the mix show that they promised me.
Yeah.
I was like, fuck y'all. They was like, well, we want you to quit the other station first. Give me the big show first.
Yeah, then I'll quit.
There you go.
But you were still on at the university?
Absolutely. My thing was is, dog, on a 16-watt radio station, because that's what WPTS is, I had 250,000 listeners. You know what I'm saying? 250 in Arbitron. You're going to find me every single time because I'm wreaking havoc on whoever you put against me.
Yeah.
You're gonna find me.
Yeah.
So again, leverage. Yeah. You came for me, I didn't come to you. So if I lose it, but I gotta follow it. So I wanted to incorporate underground, because I mean we was trying to, you know what I'm saying, not so much change the image, but deepen the top.
Yeah.
And I wanted to have them, you know what I mean, I would do an underground break in the station, or they would get me doing a simultaneous break over the air with the TV, slide into it, and if we had the video to the song that I introduced.
Yeah. Use them both. Yeah,
why we wouldn't try that shit. So they're like, you can't do that shit no more. So I don't mind. I did like maybe two episodes like that.
Yeah.
And they killed that. But at that particular point, video shows were starting to become obsolete because BT was no longer playing music. And MTV had stopped playing long before that.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about MTV jams that they created solely for MTV. All the videos that they were still getting. Because that's where the fuck that comes from.
Yeah.
I'm talking strictly the regular MTV.
Yeah, where, I want my MTV.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So now it's starting to come obsolete. So folks is like, okay, well, we watching it for Underground. What Underground? If it happened to be a show that we didn't necessarily have one, we didn't have one lined up, and the cats down south didn't lace us that particular episode, it's like, where the girls? Where the girls? I'm like, well, they ain't really checking the videos on me.
Yeah.
It's like, all right, you know what I mean? And then the videos started getting cheesier and cheesier anyway. It's like, ah, fuck.
Yeah.
So on that one, Adam decided to rap, which was cool.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But we brought it to an end quietly, gracefully, and kept it pushing. But that was 17 years, and out of that 17, I was in for 16.
17
years. That's dope. Because like I said, that inspired me, because at one point I would have a radio show on Blakk Talk, and I would go on air from maybe like 10 until midnight.
Right.
Then at midnight, like on Wednesday night at midnight, my TV show would come on PCTV.
Right.
And I'd be like, everybody listening, turn on channel 21, Comcast, if you're on Verizon, channel 47, and watch the video show.
Right.
And like my video show wasn't videos, it would be like footage I filmed out at people's performances.
Right.
You know, like I might have, you know, I don't know, like Boca performing or like whoever performed in the show, like I have footage for, I would put it together for an hour, and that's what I would do. So that's where I got the inspiration from.
Right.
Underground hip-hop.
Right. I mean, literally, man, with that show, man, we did so much. Like, we got a chance to cover so much shit. You know what I mean? We got a chance to see a bunch of shit that probably we would have never seen. And we got a chance to take our audience with us. But the one thing, one of the biggest things that I was most proud of about underground hip-hop, and I bullshit you not, we competed with Monday Night Football.
Yeah, yeah.
We competed with Monday Night Football.
Yeah.
We had from 11 to midnight, which was the third and the fourth quarter.
Yeah.
We're fucking with the game in Pittsburgh.
Yeah, motherfuckers like.
Yeah, they going back and forth.
Yeah.
We're fucking with Monday Night Football. That shit was huge.
Yeah.
We brought PCTV their biggest numbers even still to date.
Yeah, I would definitely imagine that. Definitely.
Because out of the fans that we had them. And then their women was like, what the fuck are you watching? You know what I'm saying? Because they were glued to us. So then we started getting female fans.
Yeah.
It was the wildest shit. So if we garnered so much noise at one point, Ice-T had a show over in London called Badass TV. Where the Prince came over and did an expose on us to air in the UK. And again, us not knowing the business, we fucked that up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, and that's happens so much even today, you know, with a lot of different artists and a lot of different, you know, people who call themselves creating labels and, you know, management teams and whatnot. You know, I always encourage them to learn the business.
Well, bro, what made you decide to go in as a label?
Because I always wanted to be in the music business. Like, ever since I was a kid, man, you know, Berry Gordy, you know, Russell Simmons, you know, you had guys like Clarence Avon. You understand what I mean? Like, these guys, like, when I would watch, like, the Berry Gordy story or something like that, it was always intriguing to me, like, how he created artists and developed them and made careers out of them. How he just created the Motown. The Motown situation was always my inspiration.
Right.
And then, you know, I seen Russell Simmons. Then I seen, you know, Diddy. And, you know, like I said, Clarence Avon and Philadelphia International.
Yeah,
you know,
man.
Those guys, you know, and stuff like that. Right. So I always wanted to be in the music industry as an executive. Yeah, and you know, right. Back in the day when I was young, you know, I used to try my little singing thing, you know, stuff like that. But I always wanted to be an executive. So back in like 93, 94, me and my older brother Cal, you know, like rest in peace, you know, he passed away on a motorcycle accident in September. Right. But me and him, we have put together this situation. We had called our little record label. This was in 93, 94. We called our little record label Empire Records, right? Now we didn't know. We had no idea. We had no idea that there was already a company called Empire Records.
Right.
Up in New York.
Right.
We never knew that.
Absolutely.
So, you know, I was in the dope game and everything. I was in the drug game.
Right.
All right. So that took my focus. You know, yeah. I was actually supposed to leave in summer, fall of 93
right.
to go to Lincoln University.
In Philly?
In Philly.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I was so caught up in the dope game, I was making so much money, I ended up catching a case
right.
when I was supposed to go to school. Mm-hmm. Caught a case of Elmore Square. All right, a little drug case.
Yeah.
So my dad bailed me out. All right, I told myself I was going to go into school like the next semester. I ended up catching another case. All right, so then when I made bond off of that, I ended up going on a run for like 4 years. But in between that time, I'm still in the dope game getting money.
Yeah.
All right, I'm moving crazy.
Yeah.
1997 became a big drug bust. Became a big drug bust.
Yeah.
You know, I got busted. You know, and
this sweeps.
What happened was, man, you know that bust was actually like a blessing. It was a blessing, man, because I got set up busted and arrested instead of set up robbed and killed.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? So
yeah.
It actually gave me an opportunity to change my whole situation. I couldn't make bond because of the two cases that I had.
Previously,
I skipped bond on them.
Yeah.
So when I caught this big case, you know, my dad bailed my brother out, but
I had to leave me sit
because they wouldn't give me no bond.
Right.
All right, so, you know, I sat down. I ended up getting my brother's charges dismissed, and I took the plea, you know what I mean, for 6 to 12, you know, because I already had two cases. They was going to knock my head off. I told my lawyer, I had Bill Different. Lee Rothman and Jim Weimer. So I said, look, man, just tell them, you know what I mean, just consolidate my cases, man, and just give me, what they did was consolidate my cases, offered me a 4-8 and a 6-2 running consecutive.
Yeah.
You know, so I said, all right, man, I'll take that, drop my brother's charges, man, and I'll take that, go back out of town. So I went, I got transferred upstate, and like I said, I used to try to sing this shit, right? When I was a juvenile, I was in the Allegheny Academy. And we was on a football team, we was on a football team, me and a dude named Delvin Taylor. We used to be in locker rooms and shit singing. You understand what I'm saying? Like in between, you know, we're in locker rooms getting dressed for the game, leaving the game, getting dressed to go, get back on the bus.
Yeah.
So Delbert ended up in the same penitentiary I was in, up Montgomery, SCI Montgomery. All right? So one day, you know, I'm sitting walking around the yard, we weren't working all this shit. I look, and I see Delbert, he's sitting at the table with his keyboard playing, you know, he playing on the keyboard and everything. You know what I mean? So I'm like, all right. I'm like, yo, what's up, Del? We talking this shit. He over there writing songs and shit, tuning in, smoking his little Blakk and shit. So I'm like, all right, man, you don't like that? I was like, damn, man, you know what, man? When I go home, man, like I want to start my own record label, man. And it's going to be called Raw Entertainment. I said, but I need the letters to be acronyms. The letters got to mean something. Every letter got to mean something.
Yeah.
He was like, rock around the world, nigga. That's what you going to do. Like, you going to rock around the world, right? I said, yeah, nigga. I said, well, rock around the world. I said, rock around the world is what it's going to be. I go into my cell that night, and I write a letter to the Department of Corporations up in Harrisburg.
Right.
Now, when you're in the penitentiary, you ain't allowed to start a business from inside the penitentiary.
Right.
So what they did, I was surprised that the mailroom even let them, even gave me the incorporation kit that they sent me. So they sent me the incorporation kit. I filled it out. I sent it to my Aunt Lois. Rest in peace, she passed away. I sent it to my Aunt Lois, all right? And she put the money order in it, $70.
Right.
She put the $70 money order in it, sent it to Harrisburg. They sent that shit. They sent my Oracle's Incorporation, all that shit, man. You understand what I'm saying? So she just put it up in the safe for me.
And this is in 97?
No, this is, I got busted in 97. Okay. I didn't get sentenced until 98.
Okay.
I got sentenced in 98, and I went upstate like May, June of 98.
Okay.
But I didn't do this until like 99.
Okay. That's why I was trying to pick one.
I didn't do this till like 99. You know what I mean?
For sure.
So, so all the time while I'm in the penitentiary, all I'm doing is screaming Raw Entertainment. Yo, I'm going home. I'm going to get this shit popping. I got all the Philly niggas on the gate. You know what I'm saying? Rapping. Across the gate. Yeah. I got Pittsburgh niggas rapping in the yard doing it. Blah, blah, blah. Boom, boom, boom. Nigga, I'm going home. It's going to be Raw Entertainment. I don't give a fuck where they was from. If they was from Harrisburg, if they was from Philly, if they was from Erie, if they was from Lancaster, York, PA, right. Even the niggas from New York that was locked up there, everybody was calling me Raw. That was my name.
Yeah.
That was my name, Raw. You understand what I'm saying? So I had everybody screaming Raw Entertainment. So when it came, I went to college while I was up there too, and I got my first 31 credits. And hotel restaurant management while I was there.
Mm-hmm.
So what I would do is have my dad and my brothers and them order me books on the music industry, like All You Need to Know About the Music Industry.
Donald Passman.
Stop playing.
Because she had
the book called Green.
Everything You
Better Know about
the music industry.
I got them both.
A girl named Dale Schwartz, she had a book about, it's called How to Start a Record Label.
Yep.
Dale Schwartz.
Yep.
All right, so everybody that had a book about how to start a record label, everything you need to know about the music industry, I ordered their books, and I would just sit down and just study them books.
Yep. Yeah.
All right, so
because Passman used to drop a new one
every three years. He always had new editions.
Yeah,
I just got his new edition.
I'm behind on that.
I just got it. You know what I'm saying? But So, like I said, I was studying, and then I ordered my own keyboard.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? I had a Yamaha DJX. That's why I had a Yamaha DJX in my cell. So I would be in my cell fucking around with the keyboard.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Getting on my cellies nerves and shit.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? It just, once it came, say about 6 months before my release, because I got released on pre-release.
Okay.
All right? I had 6 to 12. I was supposed to get released. My parole was in February 23rd of 2003, but they sent me home on pre-release February 23rd, 2002,
nice.
Into the halfway house, the renewal center now
downtown.
Yeah, man.
All right. So before I came home, I would tell my little brother Hershey. I'd be like, "Yo, my brother Hershey, my brother Cal, like, yo, man, look, we got this record label thing. We gonna get this shit popping when I come home." By the time I came home, my little brother Hershey already had Lady Harmony on deck.
He already had
my little brother Smooth Dool on
wait,
deck.
Wait. I didn't know Hersh was your brother, bro.
That's my baby brother.
I just found that out.
Yeah.
I just found that out a couple months ago.
Hersh, what up, dog?
That's my most Dool was the baby.
Okay.
Hersh is the baby for my mom.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because Hersh used to come fuck with me down at WPTS.
Okay, yeah, Hersh, man, that's my spot.
I was meeting up with him out of town whenever they were going to show at Half. I was meeting up with him. I didn't even know y'all was related.
Yeah, that's my baby brother, man. You know what I'm saying? So I told Hersh, he would be like, yo, listen to this. They would be in the studio with Jay Pad.
Yeah.
This is
Pad, what up, dog?
This is before I even got home.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? So, you know, like I said, I got home. They had me in a halfway house and shit. And I was in Don Renewal Center for like probably about a month. And then they moved me over to the Goodwill halfway house down on Carson Street. Yeah. So then Hershey and them, they would come pick me up and shit. We'd go to the gym, fuck around. And then I would sneak over to the studio with them on my little passes and shit.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's when they was creating that heat. And then we start fucking with the boy, Mr. Greedy Deuce.
Okay, Bell Super. Yeah, Bell Super.
You understand what I'm saying?
Shout out to Greedy.
Yeah.
Deuce was wild, dude.
He was, yeah.
Yeah.
Deuce was hot, though.
Deuce the animal.
Yeah.
Deuce tried to overcharge me for a track, though.
Yeah.
I'm just letting it be known, dude.
He didn't make it on that music for Huck.
Deuce and them Greedy records.
Yeah.
Rough Drip and all them.
Drip.
Rough Bone.
You know what I'm saying? My little brother Tizzy was with him.
All them, J Rock.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
With Max Weddy. Wax Daddy.
Wax, what up,
man? You know what I'm saying? All them niggas, man. You know, so I came home, and that's when I transferred all my credits over to CCAC. Got a job down the Sheraton Hotel, working the night. I was room service at first. Not room service, but I was housekeeping at first.
Yeah.
And then I got the night audit job. But then I started interning over at Mama in the promotions department. You know what I'm saying? So that's when I started networking, and you know.
Wait, what year was you interning over there?
I was over there in 2002,
2003. Man, you came after me.
You see, what happened though is that in 2003, I ended up catching a case coming from California with like 150 pounds of weed, man. While I was on parole, me and my brother. You know what I'm saying? So I ended up going back to the penitentiary.
Mm-hmm.
My brother stepped up and took the case. That's the same brother. When I got his charges dropped on our case,
he stepped
up and took this one
and
got my charges dropped, and you know he took a plea on that.
Yeah.
All right, they only gave the nigga like 6 months house arrest on that lead, man.
Because
so I had to go back on a parole violation for leaving the state without permission. And back then, when you was on parole, you couldn't have no cell phone.
Nah.
That was in 2003.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So they sent me back upstate. So when I go back upstate, I make re-parole in like 3 months, but New York had a detainer on me saying that I sold some shit to an undercover cop in New York, blah, blah, blah.
Oh,
some bride, the bride that set us up on a weed case, little Puerto Rican shit, set me and my brother up on a weed case coming from California. She had set me up on a coke case in New York months before that. We didn't even know it. You understand what I'm saying? Like, we didn't even know this shit. So they extradited me to I was in the Tombs in New York for 2 months. And then they overrode me in Rikers Island. So I sat on Rikers Island for 22 months fighting my case back and forth.
Right.
I ended up beating my case on speedy trial rule, 30-30, and the 580-20 interstate agreement on detainment rule. I did my own law work. You understand what I'm saying? I did all my law work.
Right.
And I made my attorney do what I wanted him to do.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
He was your consultant.
Fucking right. I made him do what I wanted him to do. My sister, my brother's girl, his kid's mother, she was going to Princeton University at the time. She was in law class up there.
Yeah.
She was in law school up there. So I would literally sat down in my dorm on Rikers Island and write out my fucking motions and send them to her, and she would type them up, and she the one that sent them to the clerk of course, the pathonitary, the lawyers, the DA, all that shit.
Yeah, yeah.
So one day, my lawyer, he come up to Rikers Island to come visit me. But he was like, man, you know, like,
what do you mean?
What did you do? I said, what you mean? I sat down, and I took a class on Rikers Island. On Rikers Island, they got a class that you can take to teach you how to study, research law, how to shepherdize cases and everything. You understand what I'm saying? I took that case. And that was part of me hustling, man, because I was a hustler on Rikers Island. You understand what I'm saying? Pittsburgh. That's what everybody knew, was in Pittsburgh and Raw.
Yeah.
So what I would do is I got a job with a sanitation crew, and that allowed me access to the whole Rikers Island, whether it was C-73, C-74, the Beacon, like, HDM was shut down at the time.
Yeah.
But no matter what building it was, I was always in those buildings cleaning up this shit. So I got in with the law clerk at the law library. So man, she was just like, Collins, you can come down anytime you want to. And then my supervisor, shout out to Miss Cassie, Dave. You know what I'm saying? She would be like, Collins, just go ahead and do your law work. You know, so I would go down there, and man, everybody was just helping me out with my case. Man, my lawyer, he came up to Rikers Island. He was like, yo, man, like, what did you do? Who put this together for you? I said, I put it together. And my sister typed it up and sent it to me. Now go put it in, because we had to go the next day. That was September 2nd of 2005. We had to go in to court, because we kept going back and forth, and they kept postponing my shit.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? So he put it in September 2nd. So the judge, Judge Solon, part 60, you know, sat down in the Manhattan court. You know what I'm saying? She recessed it until the 18th of September.
Right.
All
right?
So September 18th, we walked into the courtroom. All right? They on Rikers Island, they wake you up 5, 6 o'clock in the morning for everybody to get ready, because they got different buses going to different counties.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So they got me down to the motherfucking tombs like about 7 o'clock in the morning. Everybody going to court but me, they got me sitting in the motherfucking courtroom, I mean in a fucking bullpen, until like fucking 3, 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Finally, they come get me. They take me out. No, they come get me and they tell you my attorney wasn't there. So they take me out, and Judge Soloff and the district attorney and all of them standing over. Judge Soloff was like, Mr. Collins, your attorney is not here. Do you want to proceed? I said, yeah, I want to proceed. So the district attorney, they start speaking, you know, about, she asked the district attorney what their response to my motion was.
Right.
All
right?
So they was like, well, Your Honor, the people of New York, we concede. He said, the people of New York, we concede, and we dismiss all charges. You understand what I'm saying? So I'm looking, just so I looked at me and shit, and she just started smiling like, Mr. Collins, you free to go. But the court reporter was like, whoa, no, he's a Pennsylvania inmate. He's a Pennsylvania inmate. He has a detainer from Pennsylvania. He can't go nowhere. We have to call Pennsylvania. So they put me back in a bullpen. 5 minutes later, they came back. They said, Mr. Collins, you free to go. In New York, you can walk right out the courtroom.
Man,
you don't have to go back in jail.
No, you don't have to go back to jail.
Yeah. You can walk right out the courtroom, man. I walked out of that motherfucker. I went down to the motherfucking Central Booking and all that shit. They gave me I think $40 and a Metro Pass.
Yeah.
Man, I caught the motherfucking train uptown at my sister's crib. My brother and them booked me a motherfucking flight. I used my Rikers Island ID, you know what I'm saying, to get on the motherfucking flight back to Pittsburgh.
Right. Mm.
You know what I mean? So that was when I got home. I said, fuck that, man. We grinding, man. That's when we put together that Beat Biters Volume 1 with Raw Entertainment, Lady right. Holly, Smooth Dude, Murder Mouse, Snook, you know what I'm saying? Right. Harvey, and Miss Money.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? We put all that together, and we put that shit out in the streets, man. And I've been grinding ever since, man.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's just that, man, you know what I'm saying? Like, I've been grinding, I've been bumping my head, I've been learning, I've been growing. It's just like, for a long time, I didn't have the right team around me.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? I was grinding, but there was a lot of people on my team that wasn't right.
That's real shit, though.
They were just grinding.
So, I don't learn so much. And even with the team I got now, it's like, you know, I know a lot more than what I knew. We growing, and we ready to go. We ready to go now, man.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
But see, but that's just it, fam. And that's why I always tell cats, man, as far as like this industry shit, man, when you got people that know or are willing to learn, building is key.
Yeah, when you're dealing with a lot of different people, man, you're dealing with a lot of different personalities, egos.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Who are you telling? Listen.
Like, man, that shit is crazy. I wish
you so many artists on that lower level. I've been through like 10 different artists in and out of my camp on the lower level.
I know exactly what he's talking about.
Man, from a DJ standpoint, from radio to the club, dealing with these artists, man, it is the most annoying shit. Literally, I can take my son going da 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 before I can take a local artist because they don't know the business. You know what I'm saying? There was like I was telling you about my days at Crowbar. The part I didn't finish about that story, the truck I bought at the time was $27,000. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I bought the shit stripped. I ain't need it way down.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was brand fucking new.
Yeah.
Within 8 months, I had 10 grand on spend money that I put towards that truck.
Yeah.
To the point where J.B. Morgan Chase was calling me like, listen, we need you to slow down on your payments. You're paid into the next year and a half. I said, no, I want this bitch paid off. Because these dudes was paying me for interrupting my fucking mix. In promo. And it cost them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, I'm talking $300 a head.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Just so you would play their music.
But you got to figure at this particular point, dog, I mean Crowbar,
yeah.
The building held 1,100.
Yeah.
I had 1,100 upstairs.
Yeah.
Weekly.
I miss Crowbar.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. all these places, this was me.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I had 1,100 people on a weekly basis hearing their music.
Yeah,
you're gonna pay for that.
Yeah, no doubt.
But with me being a DJ, you know what I'm saying? A sole controller. I knew what I was doing.
Mm-hmm.
So my thing was, nah, motherfucker, you gave me the money. Nah, I'm not playing it immediately, nigga. But
yeah. You're
going to get your money's worth.
Yeah.
So when I wanted to get the people off the floor for a second, let them breathe, so that way niggas wasn't passing out from their liquor. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, Crowbar was hot. Fuck it.
Yeah.
So I would put their shit on. They cleared the floor.
Yeah.
As it was supposed to. So that way niggas can go to the bathroom.
Yeah.
I would feed the bar, hey, while the song's playing, hey, yo, you make sure you tip in my bartenders.
Yeah.
You know, I took care of the house.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So not only did I give, because I was making more than any DJ in the state, with the exception of Nick.
Yeah.
So not only was I getting my salary, the house was tipping me, because they making anywhere between 40 to 80 grand a night in 3.5 hours.
Yeah.
Now, I'm making money off of these artists that are interrupting my mix. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Now, see, the one thing about me, which was different than a lot of these cats that was DJing, is, you know what I'm saying, there's a bunch of soft cats that's out there behind the sticks. I just wasn't one of them.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So when they would come talking crazy, I throw something on and I'll come from around the table.
Mm-hmm.
Now, at 6'5", and at the time I weighed, 260? I dropped some pounds. So now I got an attitude. So now you're getting Francis Street, apartment 781, 15219. I'm like, yo, I might work for Wambo, but I ain't Wambo. Fuck you up. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Lower your voice.
Yeah.
What do you want? So now it's different. So now, all right, cool. Well, he a real nigga DJ is how they looked at. All right, cool. So we ain't going to approach still with the bullshit.
Yeah.
But I would tell him, and I would try and warn him. Like, yo, dog. If you give me this shit ahead of time, allow me to listen to it.
Yeah. Nobody's gonna play. No DJ's gonna play with my record.
Right. This right here don't have to happen. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I said, and then more importantly, I'm one of those few people that either I like something or I don't. And if I like it, I always like it.
Yeah. Yeah. You play it.
You know what I'm saying? And if I don't, if it's a business move, then I'll do it.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, I understand.
But at that particular point, you and I don't have a relationship. You didn't do what you were supposed to do to make the song hot, so now it's really not a business move.
Yeah.
You're annoying. Now this is interrupting. You're going to pay for my time. Is what the fuck's going to happen.
Yeah, yeah.
So there was always a plan. Now there were instances where artists did what they're supposed to do, which came back to my whole whack music post. It's what I'm saying. You know what I mean? Because they were sitting there, couple cats from Philly chimed in. You know, I got people from all over the place.
Yeah.
Chimed in, was like, man, there's good music out there. You got to search for it. But what happens when you don't do the legwork to make your music hot? You know what I'm saying? And the reason why I'm coming to this is because your artist, Asco, is an example of one of the ones that put the work in to make himself hot. I had to go find Dabble. It wasn't sent to me. But the shit was so Hush, on fire, I went and got it. So it became a part of the mix.
Yeah.
I have to this day, it's what, March, whatever, 2017, I ain't never met Asco. And Asco's been in my rotation.
That's crazy.
You understand what I'm saying? But when you do what you're supposed to do to make your music hot, we ain't got to go through the fuckboy shit.
Yeah, yeah.
But when you don't do what you're supposed to, and get mad at me because I don't play it immediately, because you didn't do what you're supposed to do.
And give it to me beforehand. Yeah.
Now you know what I'm saying? Now you upset. And then, if you tell somebody, oh, man, I don't like this shit, dog. Now you're a hater. You're a hater.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You don't know what you're doing. Yeah. I'm like, wait a minute. How much did you spend to get in here? You know what I'm saying? How much did you spend to get in here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what you spent, multiply that a few times. I'm getting paid that. For you to even have this conversation with
me. Yeah. You had to pay to come talk to me.
All day long.
Yeah.
All day long. So that shit was, to me, it was amazing. But the grind to make yourself hot is key.
Yeah.
S Money, I had to chase down, I'm the man. And S was my man. I'm like, how the fuck am I the only DJ in the city who don't have it?
Yeah.
Like, he got them song. When he got me the song, the shit that I did to it, he would come to Crowbar, you know what I'm saying? You know them Gopher boys came? Yeah. You know what I'm saying? The Longer boys came deep. And I would break it down. I would coast to coast. And I just got paid. It went, I just got paid to the point where he came and did an impromptu performance of the song. Them motherfuckers was jumping so heavy, I felt the floor in Crowbar shake. The only other time I felt it shake like that was when Gucci Man was high and not performing. Where they did that master fast sweep. You remember that night?
Who did they get?
They got a couple murderers.
Was that what they, when they got young Wu-Tang, you know, from up Broad Street?
Yeah, man. They was getting motherfuckers from all over the city because everybody came out for good while. There was, like I said, the building only held 1,100. Now that's Crowbar and Sports Rock.
Yeah.
We had 1,500 that night. When Gucci was there.
Yeah.
And somebody came to me whispering, he's like, yo, so the fan got the street locked off. They're looking for somebody in here. So at the time Gucci performed, I was like, fuck it. So I went to the balcony and I looked. Three blocks in that direction, black cars with the lights. Mm. Up by 20th.
Damn.
Black cars. You couldn't get to Smallman. At this point,
because
they was getting who they was looking for. At this point, that shit was crazy. But local niggas was winning in music at that time. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? At that time, them hardcore entertainment boys paid enough to make I'm Jiggin' Hot from the Valley.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? They paid enough for that. And I'm the Man was still killing shit. Don't forget what else. There was another local song that was big around that time, too. I don't remember. But, you know what I'm saying? So, Guwab in there, I don't know how much we remember because he was hot. You know what I'm saying? His hype man was singing his shit that night.
Yeah.
And he, like, bounced it. And the only reason why I saw that is because they closed circuited the shit through the club with all them TVs behind them. Yeah. And at that time, niggas was grinding. So now, labels are keeping an eye on Pittsburgh because now we're making noise. We're broadcasting this shit on the air. We're playing music. You know what I'm saying? And during my blackout mixes on Wham, I put my job on the line multiple times to play local shit. Because I wasn't allowed.
Yeah, I know.
You know what I'm saying? But the shit caught so much fire that they started doing whatever the fuck that shit was on Mondays.
Local Love.
Yeah, there you go. Well, that was a direct baby in me. Because when I played, the crew got paid, the malfunction.
Crew got cut.
And these is classics, though. I just said, you know what, I'm going to do an old school Pittsburgh hip-hop mix. Strictly Pittsburgh. So now I'm playing the Mailman, Ghetto Soundcheck, and I did a radio edit on It's Your Birthday. F3.
Yeah, yeah.
The phone lines never stopped. They was calling the administrative offices during the week. Why ain't y'all doing what Blakk still doing? Why ain't that shit regular?
Yeah. Yeah.
And it came to be. You know what I'm saying? So now they're giving it a little bit of light. But then that goes into what I was saying about not using resources. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Why snub? You don't snub somebody that you don't know who they're connected to.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, okay. Chevy got his online station Square One.
Yeah. Big up Chevy.
Shucks. Grind Hard DJs, you know what it is. But I didn't know that he got relatives in the industry. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But the local cats are not getting him the music. My thing is how are you going to be Kobe in a pickup game? When you win, what do you win?
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? And this is the attitude of 9.5 out of 10 local artists. Is that bullshit?
Yeah.
And
it's crazy.
To bring it together, man, the first thing that has to happen is, number one, they got to drop the ego. And number
that's
two,
that's the number one thing. That's the killer.
Yeah.
And they got to learn about the business.
Yeah, yeah, no doubt. Because as you can see, by just listening to Terrestrial Radio, which is on its way out,
like a motherfucker,
it's programmed. So the music that they're playing is not really the best music, but
it's what's paid for.
Exactly. You know. So I mean, you don't necessarily have to have the greatest music. You have to have the business knowledge and know how to get music to the right people
right. And
the right places at the right time.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And they don't know how to do that. They right. Don't.
Yeah.
And when you try to tell somebody, you're like, I tell people all the time, I'm like, make a fucking radio edit. Make a radio edit. If you're not making a radio edit, what the fuck are you doing this for?
Yep.
What are you doing this
for? And you gotta be ready to go. You have to be ready to go.
Because
there are certain markets that are actually still willing to buy independent music.
Yeah.
I was DJing in D.C. one of the many times I was down because I was going back and forth for 2 years spending down there. And cat named Chris Mitchell. Shout out Chris.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, I tell Chris's story. Chris, don't get upset, but you're guilty, dog. So you got to own this one. So he did this joint. The song's called Fade Away. Now, mind you, this song is still being played by my DJ team down there to this day. But this goes back 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
So I played the shit down there. Because, I mean, you know what I'm saying? They're into that type of field. You know what I'm saying? And it sounded like a track that Dilla made.
Yeah.
So I'm coast to coast and shit. Then I let it go. And they come in. Fade away. Fade away. I just can't let you. Soon as it got to that part, whoo! Everybody rushes me like, yo, is that the new Slum Village? Is that a Dilla joint? It's like, nah. Right here.
This is hard too. I've always liked
it. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I said, this is Pittsburgh. They was like, where can I buy it? Boom! I sent them a text message. Tell me your shit is on iTunes or Amazon because I got sales right here. And he said, well, no. If you go to my SoundCloud, you gotta be ready to go.
Yeah.
You have to be ready to go.
Yeah.
You gotta be ready to make money. When you decide to drop shit on the market,
yeah.
If you're not ready to make money, then what are you doing it for? It's not
a
hobby.
Yeah, that's true.
You know what I mean? But what do you look for in your artists? Because we're talking about building, branding.
One second before that, because you said you haven't met Asco, and it's crazy because Asco is my cousin. And I had no idea he was my cousin.
Oh, isn't that your real last name?
Yeah, that's my real last name.
Okay.
Yeah. 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 His mom was a good night.
Yeah.
And I had no idea because I asked him, I'm like, because I found out about SIBO. Rest in peace, I never met him before, but I found out he was related to me. So I asked him, I'm like, what made you make that song? And he was like, that's my cousin. I'm like, you're my cousin too. And then I found out about his mom.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's big family.
That shit is crazy.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's a small world.
Yeah, no, but what I'm looking for is an artist, man, you know, and my artist in particular, you know, is that marketability, first of all.
Yeah, that's key.
You know, talent, you know, you can be the most talented artist, man, and if you ain't got no hustle, no grind, then you ain't gonna do nothing.
Right.
You're just gonna be a talented, lazy bum. Like, that's all you're gonna be.
Facts.
You can be the hottest nigga on the fucking planet, and if you ain't got that hustle, if you ain't got that drive, then you ain't gonna get it.
Right.
Yeah.
What I look for in my artists is the hustle, the drive, marketability. You know, and somebody who's willing to listen. You got to be open-minded.
Mm-hmm.
You got to be willing to learn.
Yeah.
You got to be willing to grow.
Yeah.
You have to be willing to be different and to stand out.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I mean? You can't be trying to sound like everybody else. If you coming in the game right now, you can't be trying to sound like Lil Yachty. You can't be trying to sound like Kodak Blakk. You can't be trying to sound like the Migos.
Right.
You can't be. You have to be original. You got to stand out. And you got to be ready to work, ready to grind. You got to be open-minded, ready to listen, communicate.
Yeah.
And that's basically, that's what I look for.
Yeah.
As far
any artist I do.
That individuality, all you got to do is take your artist to New York, take a Manhattan, and take a walk. Because with that shit, and I learned this on my first trip to New York, it was about this shit. So you got the homeless people who are out there doing shit. Like, there was this one guy, this was in Lower Manhattan, around the towers.
Yeah.
So they used to have, like, these triangular-shaped tiles, cement tiles, you know what I'm saying, on the sidewalk. So what dude would do is he was sitting down, he had a whole bunch of pennies, he would sit down and he would make, like, different designs with the penny. The people would come, drop more pennies, or drop more coins, for him to make designs. That's how he was making money. Mm. You understand what I'm saying? But that, fam, that's what I'm saying. If you go to New York and you take a walk, the shit that you see in terms of the hustle, now never mind, you know what I'm saying, the three-car Molly shit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? My nigga from Ohio got gap with that dumb shit.
Everybody get
No, 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 no. Listen, hell niggas wasn't getting gap with that shit. Let's go ahead and keep that phone. I knew who the plant was.
Man, niggas used to get got down town.
I knew who the plant was.
You know what I'm saying?
Right. I knew who the plant was. I was like, yo, I said, this motherfucker the plant. I said, they're going to come through and miraculously win. You're going to lose. Don't put your money on that day. You know what I mean? So I go to the deli. I get a sandwich. I come back. This motherfucker broke.
Sick as hell.
Sick. But then you go a couple blocks up, you got the African selling Scullies, umbrellas, hustle. You know what I'm saying? Ain't none of those people doing the same shit, but they all drive.
Yeah.
And that, to me, you're right. That drive and that individual, that's key.
Yeah.
See, I always tell people, I tell artists, man, like, when you walk into a room, you want to be the only black suit in a room full of white suits.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? Because automatically, you're going to draw the attention.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're the only black suit in a room full of white suits, all eyes are going, you're the only black dot.
Yeah.
All eyes are going to draw on you immediately.
Yeah.
And at that point is when you got the opportunity
to
show exactly what the fuck you got to offer.
Yeah, because all eyes on you.
Right.
That's when you got all eyes on you and you got everybody's attention. That's when you got the opportunity. That's why you have to be different. Do something that's going to catch everybody's attention.
Bang.
Right.
But if you try to be and do what everybody else is doing, all you're going to do is blend in the fuck in.
Thank you. Like, we already got that 10 times over.
Facts.
Exactly. All you're going to do is blend the fuck in.
Exactly.
Ain't nobody paying you no attention.
Nah. And I'm going to even tell one of my trade secrets to this day. So a lot of cats are still sending me music to listen to. And because, like, a lot of cats
are music every day, all day.
Bang.
I get some heat, and then I get some garbage.
Yeah.
What's the percentage rate about?
Well, now, in the past like 3 years, I want to say 75% heat.
Okay.
25% garbage.
That's not a bad percentage.
Because now, Pittsburgh artists are starting to step it up, man.
Yeah.
Pittsburgh artists, we got a fucking gold mine in Pittsburgh right now.
When you posted that CD I gave you years ago, I'm like, why would he even post
Like, we got a fucking gold mine in Pittsburgh. Yeah. Artists, they everybody's coming. They starting to take this shit more seriously.
Yeah.
You understand what I mean?
Yeah.
They starting to focus more on the craft and on
the business aspect, the
music, and creating good shit.
Yeah, because I mean that.
Like, I'm proud of these dudes.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I'm serious, man. Like, a lot of these different artists, man. I'm like, man, I'm trying to bury Gordy this shit, man. Let me get this. See, you got to focus on one artist at a time.
Yeah.
Yeah, especially me. Like, I spend my own money. Right. I don't have an investor.
Yeah.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. I spend my own money on my artists.
Yeah.
You understand what I mean?
Right.
So, I got to focus on one artist. Once I get Asco out the gate and get him popping and we start creating, you know, noise and we get them to pay attention to us, I'm grabbing everybody who's trying to work in it. And I'm trying to Motown this shit, man.
Yeah, yeah, no doubt. Hold like, the door open, Mom. You got one in there, you're going to hold the door open while you have the handle.
I'm trying to bury Gordy this shit. Right. You know what I'm saying? And even other labels who's trying to put their situations together and you know, we can all link up.
Yeah, yeah.
We can all help each other, man. Yeah. So it's like, man, that's my main focus out here, man, is that we got a fucking gold mine. Yeah. We can be what Atlanta is. We can be what LA is. We can do what New York is doing, what the Chicago boys is doing right now.
Yeah.
You understand? What we can do what the fuck we want to do.
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
If we just put our heads and our resources together, put our egos and our pride aside, and stop acting stupid.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Right. We just start acting. Everybody call themselves hustlers, but they ain't thinking like hustlers.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because hustlers know how to go get the money. They know what it's going to take to get to the money.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
A true hustler ain't got no pride, ego issues when it comes to business.
Yeah,
exactly.
When it comes to getting to the money.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? So once niggas put the pride and the ego down, you know what I mean, we can all get together and get this motherfucker money. I want to shout out Dion, Grammo, Dion,
Bree Dookie, what up, baby?
Lee, Feats.
Feats, what up, baby?
My man, Lay Lasky. We about to put something together crazy, all right? Y'all, good night. Sir. You know what I'm saying?
Black Steel,
you know what I'm saying? Yes. And you got the boy Mike Carroll over there with EFB, Latia, and all them.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Lonnie Sykes, shout out to my man. Because Lonnie's been a big help. Lonnie's been a huge help, man.
Yeah. Then you got
Kevin Stevens. He got the boy Young Nizzy right now. Fly Nizzy right now. Mm-hmm. And he working with him, man. He doing his thing with that. You know what I'm saying? I mean, everybody that's out here working, man. You know, keep working, keep grinding. It ain't easy. It ain't easy grinding.
Not at all.
It's going to take time.
But you got to put the work in.
It's going to take money. You're going to get frustrated out of this motherfucker. Shout out to Ill Gil, Asco, my nigga Owe. You understand? I'm going to tell you something, man. Owe is one of the realest niggas I know.
The funny thing is, I was having a discussion about him. I know some of his people. I said, Owe been around for so long, I thought he was older. When I say around, like forever, like easy a decade and a half.
Yeah. Owe is a smart motherfucker.
Yeah.
Owe is very intelligent, man. I learned a lot from Owe.
Yeah, he hopped on that riffraff tour.
You understand what I'm saying? But what I'm saying, like, as far as business is concerned, Owe is a marketing genius. He is very creative.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, Owe, like, even from the first time I started working with Owe, you know what I mean? He's like, bro, we need to do this, we need to do that. Let's fly out to L.A., but we're going to go meet with Marlon Singleton over at University. Interscope. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Marlon introduced us to Troy Mitchell, Troy Marshall.
Yeah.
He put us with Troy Marshall.
Is he still in the game?
Yeah, he's still in the game. Troy, he radio program. Okay. That's what he's doing.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But, you know, like, Owe was always a hustler, a grinder. He don't wait for nothing. He don't wait for nobody.
Yeah.
He do his own motherfucking thing.
Yeah.
He's a businessman. You know, there's a lot of guys out here, man, who I got great respect for, man. Like, I fuck with everybody.
Right.
You understand? I ain't got nobody who I don't like.
Right.
Who I don't fuck with.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? I don't get into that. You know, there's a lot, like I said, you know, Mike Carroll, he doing his thing. You know what I mean? Lay Lansky. Boaz, my favorite rapper.
Yeah, Bo.
You know what I'm saying? Like, Boaz is literally my favorite rapper. Yeah, Bo Bet. You know what I mean? Shout S Money come on. Shout out to S Money, he on the way home. You know what I mean? Man, it's just so many, man. So many, man. So many. Rough Bone. Shout out to Rough Bone.
Yeah,
Rough. You know what I mean?
Rough been around forever.
Rough been around, and Rough been around, and Rough been grinding.
Yeah,
you know,
he like changed hats and he got busy.
Yeah, Rough, like, he's an OG out here.
Absolutely.
Really. Yeah, he is, man.
Matter of fact, that's probably who I'm going to sit down with next. Because I'm going to probably keep doing this.
Like, man, it's just Pittsburgh, man. We can do what the fuck we want to do if we put our heads and our resources together. I'm talking about music, film,
all that shit.
Yep. Music and film.
Yeah.
We got comedians out this motherfucker, man. Yep. And that's what I want to do. I want to take these comedians and I want to create movies.
Yep.
I want to create my own. Friday, my own motherfucking, you know, my own fucking Friday, my own barbershop, my own motherfucking, we can do it,
right.
And it don't cost a lot of money,
And like I was saying earlier, there's so many outlets for content now. You know, you don't have to just stick it on YouTube and shit. Fucking Dave Chappelle just made $60 million off of Netflix.
Absolutely.
You know, crushed them.
Lua Pratt, shout out to Lua too.
Yes, sir.
Kevin Hammond, shout out to my man Devin.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Push.
Kelvin and Tone and them, you know what I'm saying? Uplift Entertainment, Tip Off. Yeah. Man, it was my. You want to talk about some real, genuine dudes, man? Kelvin, Tone, there was some genuine dudes I know, man.
Sure.
I swear, man, there was some real, genuine guys, man.
Right.
Like, real, genuine.
So what is it that we need, though? Because, I mean, I know, like, we need an infrastructure. We need more outlets, like, you know, radio, bloggers, you know, magazines. What else do we need?
We need individualism. We need professionalism. We need less egos. I mean, there's nothing wrong with thinking that you're great, but not at the expense of somebody else.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You got to leave that particular portion of your ego at the door and be ready for work. You know what I mean? Because like you said, a hustler, the only way that you can make business personal is if you're fucking up the money.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's fact. Otherwise, business is business.
Yeah.
And you have to think like that, but you have to learn the business in order to understand how to do business.
You know who I see growing? I always see something from them that shows they growing, they grinding, and they just don't stop. Flag out.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no doubt.
He always grinding, man.
Yeah.
For years.
Yeah.
For
years.
He always grinding. Always grinding, man.
Yeah.
Putting his own shit together. This motherfucker will grab a goddamn van. Put that motherfucker together there, and you see this motherfucker that last guy. You understand what I'm saying? This motherfucker in Virginia some goddamn way.
Yep.
You know what I mean? He always grinding.
Mentality, like.
You got to hustle, man.
Exactly. You can't wait on people. You got to do it yourself.
But I mean, the example of that is the fact is you put an open call if anybody else wanted to be here. You didn't want to hear it.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I was on time.
Yeah,
listen, he'll hit me and be like, he's like, bro, man, we down here in Atlanta, man. Like, I'm in Atlanta too. He's like, bro, we down here, bro. Yo, so we got the van, man. We just drove down here. We in Atlanta. Like, oh, we got a show out such and such and such. They just we putting his own show together and everything.
Yeah,
that's good shit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm serious, man. That's what he do. Like, you know, you gotta support that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You can't let nobody tell you. And your shit garbage, this shit weak. If they do, you know who's hating and who's not.
Yeah.
There's a difference between
constructive
criticism versus, oh, that shit's just whack.
Yeah.
That's bullshit.
Yeah. You know what don't you like about it?
Exactly.
Is it the sound?
Yeah.
Is it the lyrics? Is it the music? Is it the production?
You know,
if somebody can give you honest criticism, you know that it's real. But if somebody says, oh, that's just some bullshit, and they can't give you a description on what's wrong with it or why they don't like it, that's how you know somebody's hating.
Absolutely. Literally, shout out to Justeri X, because the nature of, like, when we first met was down PTS, he hated me, because for a year straight, for 52 weeks out of the year, he brought me a tape. And every week, I didn't like it. There was nothing on those tapes.
Yeah.
Until he brought me this one. You know what I mean? He would come and he came with an attitude. So by week 37, he like, I don't even know why I'm here. You ain't gonna like this shit no way. So by the time tape 53 came, I bullshit you not because I still have the tape. So I stuck it in. I'm like, all right. But all goes into saying, I will listen to anything that hits my ears at least once.
Yeah.
So he brings the tape. I'm sitting in the studio and I'm listening to it. I'm like, no, I don't like this song. So fast forward to the next. No, I don't like this shit. This is hot. Playing it next. He looked at me. He said, for real? I said, yeah. So I played it. Now, I'm going to tell you how on point I was, because another thing about being a good DJ is you have to have an ear, you got to be a tastemaker.
Yeah.
So the song that he did, and I still remember to this day, because I digitized it. The song's called Pittsburgh Press. This is when he was still with Concrete Elite.
Okay.
5 months later, Mike Geronimo came out with the same sample for Wherever You Are as a single. And I wouldn't play it in support of Jasiri's song.
Yeah.
And I told him, I said, you cannot make anything less than this from this point on.
Yeah.
If you bring anything and it's less than this, don't bring it. And he got better from that particular point.
Yeah.
So he went from hating me to thanking me because I was telling him, I wasn't saying this shit was whack. He was like, what's wrong with it? I'm like, listen, man. It sounded like it's on the regular cassette that it's on. You sound sleepy.
Yeah.
You sound like you was even sleepy. You was high when you did. You're here. Music's here. It don't sound right.
Yeah. Shit's mastered. Nothing.
No. And then just the quality of it wasn't good. But I told him that.
Yeah.
52 weeks straight, I was telling him that. I was giving him a breakdown.
Yeah.
So I did. I never shorted him on his information that he needed to go back to the studio
with.
Nowadays, if you tell a motherfucker, listen, man, that shit ain't right.
I'm gonna shoot you.
Facts. That's what I'm about to say. You gotta be ready. You gotta be ready for the bullshit.
Yeah.
You gotta be prepared. So what I normally do when I'm hearing this shit, my response to it is, it sounds like what's going on today. Now, for them, they're like, but when you pay attention to that statement, if it sounds like what's going on today, that means there's nothing special about it.
Yeah.
And it isn't.
Yeah.
Because you're sitting there sounding like a bunch of motherfuckers I don't even like. You know what I'm saying? I mean, not personality-wise, I'm talking about in terms of music.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'm not a Migos dude.
Yeah.
I'm not a Future dude. I'm not. If I don't understand your lyrics, I don't fuck with you.
Yeah.
I need to hear words.
Yeah.
Because I'm an MC first.
Yeah.
And I was a battle MC on top of that.
Yeah.
So words are important to me.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Then your beat.
Yeah.
Because if the words are good, your beat's whack. It's called a remix.
Yeah.
The words ain't worth shit, but the beat is hot. I'm going to buy the beat tape.
You know what fucks me up now? Is that, like, I just came. I went to New York last week because my daughter lives up there and she's coming back for spring break. I wanted to hang out.
Right.
Plus, one of my boys is up there. He performed for Universal. And I'm listening to the radio because I'm used to this in the series, but you know, we went up in like two cars, and like my kids came with me, and they're old enough, so they took my car that had Sirius, and me and my wife were driving around in her car.
Right.
No Sirius. So we're listening to 97 and 105.1. Don't you know, every 5 minutes I heard Bad and Bougie. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I used to come to New York to try to find the new music.
To get different shit.
And now, Hot 97, I mean, I can fuck with Bad and Bougie, and I can fuck with T-Shirt. You know, those are my jams right now. You know?
That's from months ago, by the way. Go ahead.
But I couldn't believe that, you know, New York radio didn't have any hot New York music. You know? None.
I'm going to tell you when that changed. When
iHeart.
No, this is before that. The game changed for New York radio when Master P mastered and re-released Bow to Bow, the song. That's when New York radio switched.
Damn.
Literally. Because at this particular point, when Bow to Bow was buzzing the first go-round,
yeah.
You mean to tell me the only place in this country that wasn't listening to that shit was New York? New York was looking real strange during that. So now you talking 1997. P had already had Bout About It on Smash in 95. So now it's like, okay, New York, you want to be involved. What do you need from us? Clean up the mix. Fuck you. It's the same goddamn song.
Yeah.
He owned the studio.
Yeah.
Sit it down with the engineer. Here you go. And now Bout About It is on Hot 97. In 1997. So there was your radio switch in New York. And it only went from there. Because now New York artists are no longer getting spins. South artists are.
Yeah.
But you got to understand, Luda, and I was down there for this shit. I was living in Atlanta. Luda recorded his album in Hot 107.9's studio.
Yeah, because he was on air.
Luda. Chris Lover Lover and Poom Dad.
Yeah.
I used to listen to their show over Greg Street, because that was their direct competition.
Yeah, B103.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So he recorded his album overnights down there. So the name of the album was originally called Incognito. So between Charlotte and Atlanta, he sold 50,000 copies. Independent. He had the radio backing, but you figure 50,000, $5 a piece, you're making it. You're getting that.
Yeah.
So Def Jam buys into it. You know what I'm saying? Because at this point, they open up a South office, put Face in charge.
Yeah.
Face see the numbers. Face ain't a stupid. He ain't a dummy.
Yeah.
Gotta get this cat. He's on the radio. He already has done the legwork for his exposure.
Yeah.
Everybody else rebought that same album as Back for the First Time.
Yeah.
He added 3 new songs, and it was the same shit I was already listening to 2 years before y'all bought it.
Yeah.
That's why I always tell artists, don't give up on your records.
No.
And
don't give up on your records. I don't give a fuck.
It's like, old to you, but it's new to somebody.
Yes.
All day long.
Yeah.
All day long. That was a platinum fucking album.
Yeah.
So a million different people bought that album.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And that shit was huge. I sat back and I watched the play. I was like, yo, I'm definitely paying attention to this. Because I knew it was coming.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He did what I was trying to. But he effectively made it work.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He literally was able to.
And plus, I mean, he was at a radio station that supports.
His PD didn't give him no bullshit about it. And he recorded it, and he got his whole crew on.
Yeah.
2 Chainz and all. Teddy Boy.
Yeah.
When he was spitting, before he changed it up to make money.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
He used to host on-air MC battle during his radio show. His boy I-20 got fried. You know what I'm saying? The boy I-20 got fried. But opened the door for all of that.
Yeah.
Independently in Atlanta, you can be an independent in Atlanta, never make it nowhere else, and you're good.
Yeah.
Houston too?
Yeah.
Texas?
Yeah. Like a motherfucker.
Oh God, man, you can go platinum in just Texas alone.
Yep.
California?
Yeah.
California.
Yeah.
They don't need to go outside their market to make no money.
Yep.
Why do you think Slim Thug and them niggas is killing them?
Yeah.
Still.
Them niggas don't need to go out their market. Them niggas are still buying Bentleys and mansions and whatever the fuck they want.
Yep. Independence.
Mm-hmm.
Independence.
Right. But he understood he was a business.
That's all Tony J. Barrett say to me. He's like, nigga, the only way you sign to a motherfucking major, nigga, is if they coming.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
They got to be coming, nigga.
Because when they coming, they got to concede a lot of shit.
Yeah.
That they're not going to concede for you. You understand what I'm saying? Now, you make enough noise, they'll say, look, man, we ain't got that. You can be like, I don't want a 360 deal. You're only a part of this facet of my life. But at this particular point, you done made so much money without them. Why even have a conversation?
Yeah.
Unless they stroking a check for anything, nothing less than $10
million. Yeah. Because you see Chance turned down 10.
Easy. Yeah. He didn't need it.
Because, I mean, honestly, the one person that did that right in Pittsburgh was Matt. You know? He stayed independent for the longest time.
And then they offered him, Warner Brothers offered him a production deal. Not, he didn't sign as an artist, it's a production deal. And they gave him $10 million. You know?
What is he doing now? I ain't heard of him.
He's still working,
yeah,
though.
Yeah, he just dropped, yeah, he just dropped the Divine Feminine.
Yeah, his market ain't us no more.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? We not a part of that wave no more. He got some new shit out.
Yeah. But I mean, he always starts here. Like, he'll, like, an album drops, and he'll do a show on a Sunday, and usually he'll go to a Steeler game, and they'll announce him at the Steeler game. And then everybody that night is across the street at stage A&E for his show. And then the tour starts. And you won't see him back in Pittsburgh for another year and a half or 2 years. And shit, he's on the West Coast. He spends most of his time out there, you know, out in California.
Yeah, he trust me, he working, he getting it, man.
Yeah, and then he signed, he got Remember Music is the name of his label. And the Come Up Boys from Brad were his first artists.
The Come Up Boys.
Yeah. Used to be part of the 58s, franchise for Vinnie Radio.
Oh, he ain't got, what's his name no more? What was the other one?
The 58s.
Terrence Cole.
Oh, 58s
was
still
on. Who was his name?
Who?
Terrence Cole. The one I was Brad out, man, used to be a part of them.
Why does that name
Phil Steele?
No.
From the, part of the 58s?
Yeah, he was part of it.
Let's see, Ghosty, Pooh Bear, Bills, Vinny Radio, Franchise.
Oh, Franchise, yeah, that's Terrence Cole, ain't it?
Okay, yeah, see, I don't know his real name.
Then he just put out a record called The Corner or some shit?
Yeah, yeah, yep. Right. Yeah, so, I mean, because basically what he did is he took the two hottest young brothers out of the 58s and signed them. Because, I mean, B. White and Mayo are the white boys in the 58s, and honestly, they spit better than Mac, in my opinion, so I mean, why is he going to sign them,
right,
you know, when they're going to outshine him? So, he's like...
Make money off of that, that's why.
Yeah, but I mean, he went and got the, he got the young boys and shit, you know, because they're on, there's some footage on them, of them on Static Selectors radio show on Sirius, just changing beats up and going back and forth,
right,
and
right,
shit,
right.
That's just... ugly. I mean, just chewing the mic down, you know.
Robin type shit. That's, hey, that's real shit.
Yeah.
But I mean, there's a couple like underground cats that's making a buzz like it was wild. Cause you know what I mean, making beats and shit. I linked up with a couple different producer cats down in like D.C. Maryland area and shit, and they were telling me how they were a huge fan of Hubs.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I said, for real?
Yeah.
I said, that's my man. You know him? I said, I told him, y'all said, what's up? But yeah. He said, no, when is he coming to perform? And I hit him on the Twitter. Like, dog, you need to do a show in D.C. ASAP. Bang. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, I mean, like a lot of these different cats, man, and they working and they grinding, but variety is key. Black suit, white broom, like you said, that's key.
Yeah.
So, I mean, my thing is you got enough trap rappers, because everybody.
Oh, yeah, trap. You trap got rap's enough, on its way out. It's dying.
You know what I'm saying?
It's almost dead.
But variety is key. It's key, because if you have a balance on one end of the scale, then it compensates for this.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I got a new project I'm dropping my ass for called Hell on Earth.
I saw the video tagging in.
It's Hell on Earth, ass.
Because the one thing I like about that shit is you put him to work. You forced him to be different.
Mm-hmm.
To come different than he has previous.
Yeah.
And under normal circumstances, I usually don't watch shit that I'm tagged in because I get tagged in so much shit. I'm just going to untag.
Yeah.
But I watched that. And I watched it again. Mm-hmm. And I watched it again. Mm-hmm. And I watched it again. Mm-hmm. And I'm studying.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So the first time, it's like, okay, ask him. See what you got. Because my biggest thing with him is, and I keep an eye on him too. You know what I'm saying? Like, I follow y'all moves. Because that lord made so much noise. Whenever a song from an artist here makes that much noise, I'm always interested in the what's next.
Yeah.
I'm always interested in what's next. Because what's next is the difference between you taking off versus you falling the Grand Canyon.
Yeah.
And I was interested. So when you tagged me in that shit, that's why I was like, let me watch this. Let me see what it is. And I watched it. I was like, this don't sound nothing like that. For me, that was great. Watch this shit again. He's actually saying something.
Yeah.
And I understand the words. Let me watch this shit again. He thought about this, right? He took time with this shit.
Yeah.
I like it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we got a couple references on here, man. I mean, I'm confident about the whole project.
Right. Because I haven't heard the rest of it, but I definitely watched that.
Everything, and, you know, I don't know who sequenced the album, and, you know, right. Do all the records. You know,
yeah.
I do all that.
I could tell that wasn't him. I knew that wasn't him. But the key to it was the part that I noticed and what I liked. You know what I'm saying? Is you pushed him to show his versatility.
Yeah.
And dog, that is key, because a lot of cats, man, they got this one lane. It's not even a two-lane highway. It's one fucking lane. There's no destination, but it's an exit like a motherfucker. You understand me?
Yeah.
We got this record called Elsa. Well, his version is Elsa Gundo. You know,
right.
But on the album, I got Elsa Gundo and the Derivatives. I got Elsa Gundo.
Right.
Yeah.
We actually shooting a video in California. But you know, I like this record, man. It's laid back, and it just give you that vibe. And he just spitting, man. It's gonna be some like house party type situation.
Right.
We gonna have the old E's, old 40s, man. We gonna have the 8-ball jackets and. This is my whole idea. For
classic shit.
Yeah,
we gonna have the low riders and shit. We gonna be in LA.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? But it's called Alistair Dundo, man, and it's you know, and his verse is, you know what I'm saying? You say you smoking endo, you say that shit was endo, but you something about, I forget, man.
Right.
But it's called Left My Wallet and Alistair Dundo. That's it's nice.
Yeah.
I like it. Yeah. I like it. That vibe. I'm actually directing the video.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? And then, like I said, man, we come in with the 8-ball jackets, the 40 ounces, the same ads. It's just going to be that.
Right.
That.
Yeah.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And with the, you know, the LA weather, and it's going to be nice. It's going to be nice.
Yeah. That's
but this whole project is going to be nice. I'm confident in this.
But yeah. With versatility, that was key.
He got a record. He got records on there for everybody.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
He got records on there for everybody, man. It's nice. And you know, shout out to him and Stevie B. Because Stevie B, he pushes the envelope too.
Yeah.
You know
Stevie,
I mean?
Workins. Stevie.
Yeah.
Yes.
No doubt. Well, gentlemen, I want to thank y'all for coming through.
Salute. Thanks for having.
Appreciate
me.
It. Looking forward to Big Daddy Kane. I can't wait for that shit.
I ain't even gonna tell you what we doing. Shout out to Phil.
I DJ every Friday at the Onyx on the South Side, but that Friday I will be off. Somebody's gonna have to cover for me.
Yeah,
because I'm going to see Big Daddy Kane.
That's
going to be.
He's coming down Room 16. All right.
I bumped into him at Pascal's, the restaurant, sitting in there eating, and he was in there eating too.
Right.
Yeah, I bumped into him here.
So, yeah.
Sermon.
And yeah, Paris Smith, man, he made a song, and I hit him. I was like, yo, I tweeted this shit. Rugged and Raw is that shit gets me charged. That sample that they use for the sing, that shit just gets me amped.
Yeah.
And the hook, I represent the hardcore, rough, rugged, and raw. That shit gets me amped. So I tweeted the shit, and he hit me back. I was like, I said, this is charge music right here. I said, this is the type of shit that had me burn down your house. He was like, yo, he was like, salute, that's what's up. I was like, I appreciate it. I said, this is my favorite joint by you. And I sent him the flick when I interviewed him for the Underground.
Oh, okay, yeah.
He was like, yo, where'd you get that shit? I said, that's me in the picture. 95, when you dropped the Shady Business. He's like, yeah, I do remember that. You know what I'm saying? That shit was big, but man, that type... And I want that type of energy again.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
We definitely can have it.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
And we'll be back there.
We're going to make it happen. Well, I mean, as far as any Pittsburgh players in the game, if they still within the sound of our voice, we got to work.
Yeah.
We got a bunch of work to do.
Yeah.
Pittsburgh, stand up.
That's what it is.
Let's go.
That's what it is.
You know what I'm saying?
Nah, no, I fuck with all y'all, man. I appreciate you letting me come through this shit.
Oh, no, sure. I appreciate you coming out, man.
That's the wild shit. Like I said, you had an open call from up with the comedy.
Yeah.
Soak this up.
Yeah.
I mean, I ain't gonna flex over there like this.
Yeah. Because, I mean, like I said, I mean, when he you said you was bringing him, I said, yeah, I'll do it.
Yeah.
Because I don't, like I said, I don't talk shop with a lot of motherfuckers. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I just don't.
I appreciate that.
Man, literally, fam. This I listen to and I watch you drop jewels on a regular basis. You know what I mean? And when you dropping these nuggets, I'm like, yo, they don't even realize how much of the game he's giving them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And you're doing something that I just wouldn't be willing to do. Because, you know what I mean? My thing is I hate to drop platinum jewels. To leave them to get stepped on and scuffed and kicked. Yeah, and you do.
You know what I'm saying?
You do. But I mean, but you actually have one hell of a life.
I want to play something real quick.
Okay.
Yeah. You got one hell of a lifeline where, you know what I'm saying, whenever you speak, you E.F. Hutt niggas. Man. You know what I mean?
Man, you know, a lot of people. I got some other business.
What up, man? For sure. Appreciate you coming through, fam.
Not a couple
of absolutely. Yeah.
Walking. Butler Jack.
Yeah, I gotta get more. Call my rent, I'll be late. But fuck it, there's a pack of beer.
can drink. Buck inside the fridge, you're my roommate, took the whole thing. That's a bummer, I'm shitty just like a plumber. I could walk into a sunny day and it could start the thunder. I'm under tons of pressure, I'm wishing that it would let up. I don't know if you can tell, but I'm getting pretty fed up. Got plenty of blessings I haven't counted. I better throw the talent in before I start rolling. Yeah. Going my way, hey, I'm looking for a way out. I know what to say, hey, I know what to do. The cards in my hand, hey, I know I gotta leave, but I don't got a plan. I'm gonna get away, get away.
Thing I change, lick it going straight, cause I'm sick of all the pain. you on the stage, crowd sitting in disdain. Oh, when I grab the mic, I let the frowns from the faces up, damn. Put my heart in the shit, going hard for this trip. Haters wanna see me down, but I'm a star, never quit. I got that real life etiquette, that real life etiquette. I'm a star, I won't ever quit. Yeah, that's that real life etiquette.
Style of the gentleman, flowing like a veteran. These people went into my life, I hold the door and let them in. I'm trying to hear their stories and not who they think they better than. Don't pay them no attention, I'm too focused on the Benjamins. Eric Ben, get a grip, hold it and don't let it slip. Can get one chance and I'm really thinking this is it. This rhythm is ridiculous. Lyrics at the infinite, by 2017, you gon' know where it limits it. Some people wanna pass away, some people wanna run their mouth. I just try to sip the tea, and it's always pinkies out. Life's too short, you gotta live it like your last day. They say the shit's a race, man, I'd rather be in last place. Racetrack vision's going slow from the start. Tripping out my mind, playing Mario Kart. Cardiac raps, I always talk from the heart. You hating on my music, your girl's calling it art.
Put my heart in the shit, going hard for this trip. Haters wanna see me down, but I'm a star, I'll never quit. I got that real life etiquette, that real life etiquette. I'm a star, I won't never quit. Yeah, that's that real life etiquette. Put my heart in the shit, going hard for this trip. Haters wanna see me down, but I'm a star, I'll never quit. I got that real life etiquette, that real life etiquette. I'm a star, I won't never quit. Yeah, that's that real life etiquette.